just trying to change the world here, people.
Oh, really?
The Facebooking and the tweeting and the Instagramming, all that would not exist without our understanding of science.
So it's amazing that you do that as an insult.
You mean true for you is different from true for anybody else?
Yeah, absolutely, because I can't
think either got to be true or not.
I can't, no.
Welcome back, citizens of Netlandia, carbon-based life forms and AIs everywhere. This is show 119, the B-side, for Friday, July 24th, a Sunday. Wait, that's right, it's not Friday, it's Sunday, July 24th, 2016. I will just switch off that. There we go. Okay, so we're going to be talking again, providing some edutainment, hopefully, about what came out of the Republican convention for 2016. We have in front of us a digital and also a hard copy of the Republican Platform 2016, and we will provide a link to that also in the show notes. I have with me Stephen Griffith, who is also with me on Friday's show. We may have David also appear. We have left room for him in the show. However, I don't blame him if he doesn't want to come back to this, because it's kind of horrible.
Now, yeah, we keep trying to find the good spots. We keep trying to find things to cheer them on about or some kind of glimmer of hope. And
I'm desperately trying to be open-minded about this.
Am I happy that they've so far stayed with the standard thoughts?
They're consistent?
Yeah, consistent. That's
consistent? Yeah, okay. So before we jump back into this headlong, because we're actually on, if you're following along at home, we're on page 23, or at least as they call it 23, it's actually something like 30 or something at this point.
Yeah, the actual PDF, it's 30 if you're following along with the PDF. Yeah.
I was right? Jeez, I just guessed. Okay. So, on the webpage for GOP.com platform, which should contain the party platform documents, it is still only showing the 2012 platform. So what it was 4 years ago. But below that, deep below that, they have a section of what it means to be a Republican. I think that's an important thing, you know, to know where you stand and how others would codify you.
Or more importantly, also, for those people who find themselves saying, calling themselves Republicans, this is what your party actually is and is holding to.
It's like,
if you don't hold to that, you might want to start thinking.
Yeah, it's like, are you really a Republican? So, some of you that aren't Republicans may very well agree with many of these things. So, they have a list of 14 items, and I have them on the screen. Should you be watching at ORLYradio.com. We have the live stream there, and also we have links to all the YouTube pages for everything in syndication. So if you're just getting this in your RSS feed and your podcast agent, you can go out to the webpage and you can watch the video, and you can see everything that we're going to go through. I will have a live feed of what we're reading through, so you too can follow along at home. I am recording it at a higher bitrate than what is going out to certain things, so you should even be able to read it, hopefully. Okay. So, with this, based on your feedback, we have compiled a list of what it means to be a Republican. I believe that our, number one, country is exceptional.
In certain ways, yes, and most of the ways they're probably thinking, no.
I believe they would
have
like
to go
it
back
to, be.
To, you know, exceptional versus the idea and doctrine of exceptionalism.
Yeah, they would like it to be exceptional.
They would love it to be exceptional.
I too would like for my homeland, if I want to go straight nationalism, I would like for my homeland to also be exceptional.
Absolutely.
However, I'm trying to think more of a global citizen. You know, I would. That's why I don't call you listeners. I call you netizens. You know, citizens of Netlandia. You know, you are of the internet. So am I. So.
Well, beyond that, we're also people who actually pay attention and don't let just the nationalistic curtain of ultra patriotism and pride drape us in its glory.
It's,
no, we actually pay attention.
It's really easy to be manipulated when you think that way.
Beyond that, it's just honestly, like a lot of, you know, dystopias and utopias have said in literature, it's so much easier when you don't have to think. When you just say, I am, and it fills you with a sense of wonder and belonging, and you just go on and you never question it.
Yeah.
Because if you start to question it, you start to realize, no, that wonderful temple, that wonderful castle has a lot of cracks in its foundation and needs to be repaired now.
It's like a studio backlot. It's just got a facade and there's nothing behind it.
Yeah.
Okay, so enough enough on section, on bullet point one. Next. We believe that the Constitution should be honored, valued, and upheld. What they don't say there is what we found out in last episode, which was they want it to be precisely as the founders wrote it, a unmoving, unchanging, static document.
And also their own interpretation, really, of what the founders thought, what they think the founders thought things were.
Right.
Yeah, on top of that.
However, I will say that, you know, our current president, the sitting president at the time of this recording, is Barack Obama. He is a constitutional scholar. Yet they always seem to forget about that, and they think that he's, like, wiping his ass with it or something.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway. Okay, so that's what they say, and then what they mean is a little bit deeper than that.
Again, on the surface, I can absolutely agree with that.
Yes, if that was precisely what it was, but if you go just slightly deeper, never changing. Which is funny. You may think that, no, it's not supposed to change. But I would like to point to their favorite amendment, the Second Amendment. Wait, if it's a document that's never supposed to change, why were there amendments?
Yep.
Why is there a built-in way to change it? It's meant to be changed. Otherwise, they were smart guys. They knew that things were going to change.
They knew they were not going to be living founding a static society.
Yeah.
And values over time will change and shift.
Yeah, their own life was not a static environment. So why would their document be? But be that as it may. Okay, so bullet point three. Believe that leaders should serve people, not special interests.
Again, 100% behind this idea.
I like
the idea.
I'm Koch behind
brothers.
That. Well, they also believe that money is speech.
Yeah. But looking at the Koch brothers, NRA, mm-hmm. Pharmaceutical industry, Big Sugar. I can just keep going on.
Yeah, yeah. That.
How it's done in actuality versus what they're trying to say here.
Yeah.
What they're saying here, that little bit, bullet point.
I love it. I agree with the bullet point. Absolutely.
with the bullet point.
So of the bullet points, we agree with the first two out of three so far. Doing pretty good, actually. Maybe we're Republicans. Maybe not. We believe that families and communities should be strong and free from government intrusion. I believe that families and communities should be strong. However, I would also like the government to make sure that the roads are upheld, that the bridges are safe to travel across, that there are government services such as police, fire, rescue. All of those are also in place to uphold the word of law and make sure that we are safe and sound and everything's moving smoothly.
I would like the government to intrude to make sure that, say, my neighbor isn't manufacturing meth and then dumping all the component chemicals into the lawn and thus right. into the, you know, local water supply.
Yeah. So I got half of that. Half of that one. So 2.5 out of 4. If you're counting at home.
We're still at a net positive.
2.5 out of 4. We're doing not as bad as we ought to, probably. Okay, so number 5, that the institution of traditional marriage is the foundation of society.
Well, let's break this down a bit, because they're using the term traditional marriage. Now, if we want to go back to selling our children for 3 goats and a cow, I'll actually give them this one.
I don't know, man. What's the conversion rate to shekels? You know, because this is it. It's a Bible ploy. You know.
Wait, hold on. My daughter's actually marrying a Canadian. What is the conversion rate between goats and beavers?
Ooh, that's the beaver reference. You got me. I can't even go there. Okay. So ixnay on 5. Can't do that one. Okay. Number six, that we believe that government should be smaller, smarter, and more efficient. Yes.
I agree with two of those 3 points.
It should definitely be smarter and definitely more efficient. Smaller is debatable. I don't think, honestly, that we need a Department of Homeland Security. I don't think we ever needed that. But now they're there, and they're taking over everything.
I understand what the purpose of the DHS is and what they were trying to do. Actual implementation is something completely different. If we get back to what it was trying to do, cool. Mm-hmm. But it's the idea, the GOP loves putting the idea of the whole, you know, we need a smaller government, we need a smaller government. Smaller does not mean more efficient. And anybody who's worked on any kind of team project knows there are times you need a minimum number of people to make this thing work smoothly.
Right, otherwise you
having less people, which would be the smaller government, doesn't mean it's going to work smoothly. Matter of fact, it can grind things to a halt.
Yeah, but really, of course, what they're talking about is also, you know, something that I'm keen on, which is the removal of entire government agencies. But
hey, if the agency doesn't need to be there, if it's being taken up by other organizations or the purpose it serves no longer really exists, that's actually the way, in truth, the funny thing is, that's actually the way it's supposed to work.
Right. In practice, it is very difficult to remove those government agencies.
Because the agency is supposed to exist, solve the problem it was put in place for, and then cease. However.
Yeah. We've seen in practice how well that actually works. But yeah, they're talking about other things, like the Department of Education. You know, bad things. We don't really want that to go away.
They're not talking about the Department of Defense.
No, they're definitely not talking about that. So that's another half. That's another half.
No. Again, we were two. That's a 0.75 or 0.66 out of
3.66. Oh, geez, we're going to actually have to start writing this down if that's the case.
Yep.
Okay. Well. All right. So at 7, healthcare decisions should be made by us and our doctors. Well, yes, I do agree with that.
100% behind that.
Yeah, I don't really want the insurance companies to make a judgment call on my healthcare. I'm with that.
Or again, let's, you know, as the science love to say, Congress regulating a woman's vagina.
So at this point, I would say that I agree with the text of the bullet point once more. I know that behind that, they want to do away with Obamacare and do something completely different. The Affordable Care Act, as it were. So, again, you know, the subtext, what they mean versus what they say. Okay, number 8, that paychecks should not be wasted on poorly run government programs. I think that that's kind of the same as number 6. Because our taxes pay for government.
Yeah.
And I guess that's the taxes coming out of the paycheck. I imagine that that's what that would be. So... I guess we have to agree with the text.
I can agree with the text.
Yeah, got to agree with the text again, but it seems... Yeah. Okay. That the military must be strong and prepared to defend our shores. Again, the text is good. I like the text. But the thing is, we're already strong. We can already defend our shores.
We could defend our shores with 1/4... besides the military currently is.
We're defending other people's shores at this point. And, yeah, that's difficult.
We're not defending one shore. We're defending all the shores.
All the shores. Our shores being the human race. All of them. I suppose we could. And we do. But, again, the text, the letter, not the spirit, I agree with. Mm-hmm. Culture should respect and protect life. I'm not sure what that means.
True, we have to interpret this one a little bit as well.
Yeah.
It's a bit vague.
So I imagine the culture would be, I'm going to go out on a limb and say this is we're a Christian nation, and that's the culture that we must uphold.
That's probably the underlying thing they're going for there, yeah.
So if we replace culture with Christianity, Christianity should respect and protect life?
Whatever it is, I
can't deny that I want it to respect and protect life. But this is also a ploy against abortion.
Yeah.
protecting life.
That's where it's going to go, and you know for a fact, because with the Fifth Amendment thing we went over earlier in this.
So again, the letter, I can't disagree with it. I can't disagree. So, okay, sure. 11, children should never be left in failing schools. Okay.
I could agree with the letter of that.
Then what do you do? Do you pull them out, or do you raise the school up to a non-failing?
Those are the two questions.
I am in favor of raising the school, yeah. The rising tide.
Fix the school.
Yeah, the rising tide lifts all boats, and all the children are in little boats, so let's lift them all up. But this is one of those ploys. Again, if we dig down, just barely touch the surface, we're going into the voucher programs for schools.
So remove all public schools, nothing but charter schools, voucher programs.
Yep, all
Christian,
that.
Private religious schools, yeah.
Yeah. Not a fan of those. Okay, 12. We're getting there, folks. We're getting there.
I'm sorry, Andy. Looking at this, I think we're half Republican at this point.
We're probably more than half Republican. Yeah, we're definitely leaning that way. Veterans should have the best care and opportunities in the world. Well, yes, absolutely. Can't deny that.
If you're willing
that.
To risk your life for the country, yeah, you should be getting some benefits out of this.
Yeah, that's the deal. That's the deal, right? Yeah,
I'm perfectly okay with that guy getting 10% off his Burger King meal.
That's cool. Yeah, not a problem. Not a problem. In practice, it would help if they actually voted for any veterans' bills whatsoever. That would be really helpful if they actually put their money where their mouth is, and they're not.
Help fund, rebuild the VA.
Yeah. Any of that. That'd be lovely. Okay. So, yes. Again, the letter, 100% agree. 13, social programs should help lift people out of poverty. That is their purpose.
That's literally why they exist.
I agree with that 100%. But I guess what they're insinuating here is that there's too many people living on the social program and never leaving the social program.
The social program is keeping them in poverty because it incentivizes not working.
Yeah.
I've heard that exact argument. So that's where I can see the underlying current of this being. Again, the text I agree with completely.
I know one, exactly one person who that has ever been a case for. And after going through the arduous process time and time again with him, it the world was out to get him. It was ridiculous. Nothing he could do was ever going to get him out. But finally, eventually, he did manage to get off most of those programs and into a stable position. But he was getting social supplement income for SSI for medical conditions. Insert vague medical conditions term here because privacy.
But yeah, there are certain people out there who just either mostly just due to issues not of their direct control that just get hammered into these positions and can't leave.
Yeah, because there's that unaccountable threshold where you can make X dollar under the table and still, or even above the table, and still be on the program. If you go just a few dollars above that, which is still below minimum wage, by the way, then you lose the program because obviously you're doing okay. But you have to jump so much higher to actually be solvent. It makes it really difficult. So it's the tiers that they have set up, they're very difficult to actually manage through. So
yeah.
Anybody that's actually spoken to people and talked to them on a human level, you'd know this.
Actually, the funniest thing is, because you can go out there and find calculators and tell you, could I get, what level can I get, any kind of SSI or any help like that? And you would honestly be just surprised at how low you have to be. And also in what very specific bracket, because if you go below that level, you also fall off the radar.
Yeah, there's a huge gap. There's just
this
gap.
Above that level, you fall off the radar.
Yeah. You have to be completely destitute.
I know people who make too little money to be able to go on these programs. And I'm like, wait, but that's the point of the program is if you don't have enough money, you...
Yeah.
What?
And I've said on the show before, it's really expensive to be poor. You know, to only be making that barest amount, you can't keep, you know, climbing your way out. It's nope. All just loose sand at that point.
You can't do anything.
Yeah.
So on the surface, we agree.
But we know where it's leading because, you know, you can read between the lines. So, but on the surface, again, we agree. America should be energy independent. Number 14 and the last bullet point. And yes, absolutely, America should be independent. Why the hell not?
But let's pull out that shovel and pull the carpet a little bit.
Well, I think we're going to have to go into the mines for this one. The coal mines.
Baby drill.
The coal mines, the fracking, the hydraulic fracking, and just...
Offshore drilling, onshore everything. Drilling,
yeah.
All the pipelines everywhere.
All the energy. Rape the land, pillage, pull it all out, and burn it all. But
gentlemen.
True.
Hey!
Hey, you are here! Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Sorry about the delay.
Congratulations, we just got through the bullet points to tell us that we're probably actually Republican.
Or could be.
Oh.
I know, it's weird, isn't it? It's so weird. Why are we Republicans? Okay. There, now I've got your head.
Technically speaking, if you believe the... if you believe just the bullet points...
Exactly.
There's a lot of Republicans.
Mm-hmm.
If because... you actually look at what they do in office.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Not a lot of Republicans.
Yeah, we were definitely talking there with the veterans should have the best care and opportunities in the world. How about a bill on that? Can we get a bill? Can we get a bill? One bill, two bills? No, nothing.
No, because that runs counter to having a small government.
Exactly. Yeah. So, yeah. So here you go, ladies and gentlemen. This was the 2012 holdover on their website for the party platform for GOP.com. Based on your feedback, we have compiled a list of what it means to be a Republican. So you can find that also in the show notes for this particular episode. Okay, so that's the wrong one. There we go. Okay, so now we are back into the party platform.
See, speaking of that small government.
Speaking of that, yes, we are on page 23, if you're following along at home in the PDF. This is the government reform. Which is, okay. Steven, did you get a chance to actually? You said that you were going to be the true masochist, and you were actually going to read through it.
I was going to try to, but then work yesterday just.
I understand.
Made my brain melt.
I understand completely. I chose to not do it.
Unfortunately, bringing this on the floor and reading it would be they would have a problem with that.
They might
mostly just because it's a lot of text and it could be distracting.
True. True that. Okay, so government reform. Making government work for the people. Oh, they're immediately calling founding fathers. Founding father and constitutional framer James Wilson. Well, he's one that you don't hear of very often. Declared mm-hmm. that in America, the people are the masters of government. But that in other countries, the government is master of the people. Okay. We pledge to make government work for the people rather than the other way around. Mm-hmm. Okay. I think that pretty much sums up this paragraph.
Yeah.
Its credit card budgets impose massive indebtedness on every American today and on children yet unborn. Oh, calling on the unborn. The more it intrudes into every aspect of American life, the more it alienates the citizens who work, pay taxes, and wonder what has happened to the country they love.
Republicans.
We agree with Thomas Jefferson.
I unmuted my mic. I'm sorry.
No. You keep on keeping on. We
so basically what they're doing there is calling out the individual family's debt economy?
Yes. That's...
That's ballsy.
That's what I take. That's what I take from it.
There's a way to not have a debt economy. You could make it so that they can't, the banks can't produce credit.
That's true. We could remove all credit. And then we would have loan sharks, because that's kind of a necessary thing to actually work.
I would like to make mention, since he's a very not talked about founding father,
yeah.
James Wilson actually advocated and argued with much fervor on behalf of a strong central government.
Really?
Mm-hmm. That nevertheless confirmed to majoritarian principles.
Okay.
This comes from his actual biography and information.
Well, okay. Much of what
was
much
was
of
it
what's
Wilson
in here.
Versus Jefferson or Adams versus Jefferson in the fight for the central bank versus decentralized banking?
No, that was Hamilton versus
everybody.
Hamilton was the one who created the whole centralized banking system.
Hmm.
Yes, things I've learned from listening to and watching a Broadway play, and then it making me want to research more and go, oh no, he created our central banking system.
Yeah. Okay. Balancing the budget.
Hmm.
The federal fiscal burden threatens the security, liberty, and independence of our nation. Okay. Current administration's refusal to work with Republicans took our national debt from $10 trillion to nearly $19 trillion today. Left unchecked, it will hit $30 trillion by 2026.
Now, let's break that down just a hair and say, you know, their refusal to work with Republicans, and I've seen those fights, I've seen those debates. It wasn't the administration's refusal to work with Republicans. It was Republicans saying,
"Our way
it's
or
my
the highway.
Way or we're shutting down the government."
Yeah.
If we don't get everything, we're shutting down the government.
Yeah, the fiscal cliff, I believe, is you can.
The administration manufactured fiscal crises, phony government shutdowns to demand excessive spending.
So they're saying that everything that they actually did over the last couple years, the Obama administration
was Obama administration's fault.
That the executive branch pulled off.
What this reminds me of a lot, honestly, is, and this is a very sad, and I'm sorry out there, slight trigger warning for what I'm about to say. This is like the guy beating his wife and saying, why do you make me do this?
Yeah. Yeah, that there's a little bit of that to this.
This is total role reversal from what actually happened.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I love that line.
The Republican path to fiscal sanity and economic expansion.
I'm totally for a constitutional requirement for a federal balanced budget.
I am for that as well.
I am absolutely for that. It will totally cripple Republicans' ability to govern.
They will never do it. They have. Okay. So Paul Ryan.
In a world where you have George W. Bush, who had Republican in the White House, Republican House, Republican Senate, this would totally destroy his ability to wage war.
Except let's back this up a bit, and I will say the reason I'm against it. You couldn't have a functional Keynesian economy in this case.
Oh, the economy would have to be totally different, yeah.
If things started collapsing, you could not then debt spend to, as we said before,
kick the
car down the hill and get the engine to start turning over.
The only way that this could work is if it is also constitutionally mandated that the government will have X percentage of gross domestic product as liquid resources to inject into an economy if it needs it.
Yeah. Now, I see here that in the end closing paragraph of balancing the budget, Republican budgets will prioritize thrift over extravagance and put taxpayers first. We support the following test. Is a particular expenditure within the constitutional scopes of the federal government? If not, stop it. Has it been effective in the past and is still absolutely necessary? If not, end it. Is it so important as to justify borrowing, especially foreign borrowing, to fund it? If not, kill it.
No, there goes all the wars.
Yeah, that has it been effective in the past and still absolutely necessary? Kills most of the military budget.
It really does.
Yep.
Therefore, it would be excluded from this.
Except that definition is different if you're Republican.
Of course, because we always want to be able to invade another country.
It powers a lot of our economy.
Oh, yeah.
Technically. So, yeah. That's... We've always been at war with East Asia. We've always been at war with Pacifica.
Easy now.
What?
Oceania can only take Oceania. So much.
I don't know what you're talking about. Okay. Preserving Medicare and Medicaid.
No, yeah. Things that they fought vehemently against.
Okay, so we intend to save Medicare by modernizing it, empowering its participants, and putting it on secure financial footing.
AKA privatizing it.
Yeah.
Well, that is what is defined as a goal. Where do they actually talk about the implementation of this goal?
Let's
see. Obamacare. This is an agenda to improve health care. Another goal. Goal.
Well, they want to do goal. It as the state's authority to authority and flexibility to exclude abortion providers from the federal programs such as Medicaid and other health care programs.
Which they already excluded, and also a goal, not an actual path to execution.
Yeah, I will say this. I love this almost prescient statement on the first paragraph of that page. Medicare's long-term debt is in the trillions, and it is funded by a workforce that is shrinking relative to the size of its future beneficiaries.
That is a fact.
That is actually entirely correct.
That is a fact, yes.
However, one of the reasons it's shrinking is because we keep shipping shit overseas.
Well, that and the following generation is actually smaller.
Yeah, we stopped breeding as much.
Stopped breeding as much.
Yeah, well, we couldn't afford it.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Okay, so what they're also saying here is that where Obamacare was saving them money on Medicare and Medicaid, because that's demonstrably true that the programs are saving a lot of money in like medicine expenses and overall healthcare standardizing treatments and things like that. This is coming from the healthcare lobby. This is coming from the insurance lobby saying that it imposed hundreds of billions of dollars in cuts to Medicare providers to pay for its new spending. Whoa, that was way more highlighting than I wanted to do. And now I can't undo it. Awesome.
Control Z.
I don't know. Maybe. Yes.
Aha! Success.
Okay.
We have the technology.
Sometimes. Okay.
We have hotkeys.
We do have some hotkeys. Okay, so... So that's... I would really love there to actually be that plan in place that they want to replace Obamacare with.
This is why we propose these reforms. Impose no changes for persons 55 or older. Give others the option of traditional Medicare or transition to premium support model designed to strengthen patient choice, promote cost-saving competition among providers, and better guard against the fraud and abuse that now diverts billions of dollars every year away from patient care.
You know what I feel like this says?
Nothing.
This says we're going to literally run Obamacare through a copy machine, and we're going to use stickers to rename it something else.
Yeah, we're going to call it something else.
We're going to pass this bill and repeal the ACA with the Republican whatever act of 2017.
The problem is the whole
you might be
promote
right.
cost saving through competition among providers and strengthen patient choice, even on the ACA and everything else. As we've seen, especially when it comes to anything Medicare or Medicaid-wise, it's the government who says, hi, this is worth this much.
Yeah.
This is how much you're getting paid. The patient has no choice because they're not putting anything out. They don't have to.
Yeah. The reason they're doing this is to save the program money, the program that's run by the government that is trying to save cost on Medicare and Medicaid, which has always been a government-run program.
Mm-hmm. And they look at providers and go, why are you charging this much? No, we're not going to pay you that much. You're overcharging by a massive amount, and screw you.
Okay, so what I'm seeing here, and we have seen it before, but now it's coming into focus, especially after that conversation with my parents.
We'll get to that later.
Yeah, well, yeah. We may not get to it. We might not have to. Really, what I'm seeing here is the facts are the same. The argument is different on both sides. And the way that the Republican mind is seeing these things is that it's all bad because they're being told that it's all bad. Mm-hmm. They're not looking at what the positives actually are. So where the Affordable Care Act is actually saving money because it's forcing a nominal value on these items, they're looking at it as it's now causing the insurance companies to then make less money. But they're not saying that to their constituents. They're saying that it is harming business.
Mm-hmm.
And thereby harming you, because the business is then going to pass that along to you.
What really, I think, chapped the ass of all the insurance companies is the requirement that they spend 85% of what they take in for patient care.
Yeah. And what is not paid out, that gets returned as a bonus.
Yeah.
To the consumer.
AKA,
destroyed their business model.
85% of your job, or...
Mm-hmm. Basically destroying their entire business model of pay into the program, never get sick, and we make all the profit.
Yep. It's literally an economic model of how much can we charge for providing how little service.
That's insurance. That's the insurance industry. You know, they win
what their profit line is defined as.
Yeah, they win when you don't use it.
Yep.
But when you have to use it, and those that are in the Medicare, Medicaid, elderly population, they are the ones that are going to use it the most right now. You know, us healthy folks that don't go to the doctor very often, or don't end up in the hospital, except for, you know, truly accidental things, we're the ones that are actually supporting the baby boomers that are going through chemo treatments. You know, that's where the profits are going. I'm okay with that. Quite literally, I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
The other mindset
is... I hope that someone will pay for me when I'm old.
Exactly. The other mindset here is that they're not okay with that. They would rather have to pay for all that themselves. Right up until they actually have to write that check, and then, boy, are they super happy that Medicare was there.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's literally a system of pay it forward.
Yeah. Okay.
Moving on.
Got that out of my system. Okay, we're just moving along. Hey, let's go to Social Security.
All right.
So speaking of the...
Saving it? Are they going to pay it back for all they borrowed out of it to pay for their wars?
A third rail of American politics where, you know, third rail, if you're not familiar with that term, which hopefully you are, is that's where all the power comes in for a subway car. The third rail that coupling rides on. It's like 600 volts.
Beyond 600 volts, it's more the amount of amperage running through there means if you touch it, you die.
It's a lot. Don't piss on the third rail. Don't touch the third rail. Stay away from the third rail. So the third
don't
rail that they're saying...
Don't cross the streams.
That's right. Don't cross the stream. But they're saying that Social Security is a third rail in American politics. Deadly for anyone who would change it. The Democratic Party still treats it that way, even though everyone knows that its current course will lead to a financial and social disaster.
Which is entirely incorrect. There is a reason it's called a third rail, is because ever since it's been implemented... It is a third rail because the AARP is the largest single voting bloc in the entire United States, which is the American Association of Retired People, mm-hmm. who will get Social Security. Go ahead, challenge that, and you will no longer have a political career. Or at least try to take it away, and you will no longer have a political career. This has been shown many times throughout modern history.
Yep.
And everyone, every economist, and every person who actually looks at it, who breaks it down, every time they will always tell you, no, it is not leading to a financial and social disaster. No, Social Security is actually fine by itself. Let it keep going. Let it keep doing what it's doing.
As long as you don't touch it,
it's for like the next 120 plus years.
As long as you don't touch it.
Yeah.
But we owe it a boatload of money.
Yeah, they've been reaching into the cookie jar.
Pays for itself.
Yeah, it's a self-funded thing.
Like
the post office, exactly. And they keep reaching into it and taking out the money that's there.
Because that's the only way they know that they can kill it, and they hate any actual social programs.
Especially ones that are working. So current retirees and those close to retirement can be assured of their benefits. Of the many reforms being proposed, all options should be considered to preserve Social Security. As Republicans, we oppose tax increases and believe in the power of markets to create wealth and help secure the future of our Social Security system.
Let me break that open right there.
Yep.
Is anybody there confused about what they're actually saying? Because I know exactly what they're saying.
Let's spell it out.
That as Republicans, we oppose tax increases and believe in the power of markets.
Those words. Power of markets. Privatize Social Security, make it a part of the stock market.
That's, yeah.
That is exactly what that actually means. Saying the power of markets to create wealth is going, the stock market's going to exist. The stock market will be fine. Oh, don't worry. Forget all those crashes and plummets and the fact that, you know, if Greece defaults, it affects us. If other countries have issues, it affects us. No, don't worry. Your Social Security will be fine. It will not be, as has actually happened to people's 401ks and such, be spontaneously wiped out. Because the market.
Yeah, never mind that we actually have proof now that the market is actually truly rigged through microtransactions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, hyperspeed transactions.
Then a human person can trade.
Yeah, it's...
Never mind that. It's perfectly okay for your retirement funds.
Yep, hyperspeed servers.
Yeah. Oh, good. My portfolio is up 0.28% today. That's nice. Moving on. It was down like 4% yesterday. Okay. it is our moral obligation to those who trusted in the government's word to privatize it, basically. But yeah, you are completely correct. That's what they definitely want to do. They don't want to. They don't want to be in charge of it anymore. They want to put it out into the public where people can then siphon more money off the top of it and make a profit off of it.
For all those people who are wondering, what they're essentially saying, to break it down into more, I hate to use this term, but it's going to be true, Trumpian levels, they want you to sell you and want you to believe that it is absolutely okay to gamble with your Social Security.
Pretty much. That's pretty much the way it is.
And if you lose it all, oh well.
Okay. So here's my third rail, protecting internet freedom.
Oh, here we go. This will be good.
This is
third rail for the youth.
Yeah, yeah. The survival of the internet as we know it is at risk.
By you.
The gravest peril originates in the White House, the current occupant of which has launched a campaign, both at home and internationally, to subjugate to its agents of government.
Yeah.
What?
Because,
what does that
again,
even mean?
The idea of making it I know what that is. It's the push to make high speed internet a utility.
Yeah. Yeah. You think that's it?
Which
yeah.
I'm all on board for.
I'm all on board for because every place that's done it, speeds are better and price is better.
Yeah, it's called municipal broadband for those that are curious for the search terminology when you're going to look.
Chattanooga, Tennessee outruns the rest of the country by about 100 times and does it for about $38 a month.
Yeah, they ran
and more
importantly,
gigabit. It keeps the not monopolies from being there.
Mm-hmm. The president ordered the chair of the supposedly independent Federal Communications Commission to impose upon the internet rules devised in the 1930s for the telephone monopoly. He has unilaterally announced America's abandonment of the international internet by surrendering U.S. control of the root zones of the web names and addresses. He threw the internet to the wolves, and they, Russia, China, Iran, and others, are ready to devour it.
Why? Because they have faster internet than we do because of how we run it?
Korea has faster internet than we do.
Korea has, I think, the fastest internet in the world.
They do. Yeah.
Because it's all fiber.
And it's all government-run.
What?
Yeah, I know. Yeah, it's crazy. Okay, so
again,
yes.
Remember, at one point, StarCraft actually was a verifiable percentage of their GDP.
What? Really?
Yeah, because of all the because that's the whole StarCraft leagues and everything else.
Yeah.
And really, esports along those lines started in South Korea.
Wow. No, I did not know that. Okay. So what they're saying here is fear, fear, fear. and the FCC is bad, and putting rules... No, we're so not done. No. No, we're not done. Go away.
That's our 45-minute marker.
That's the 45-minute marker. Yeah. We're really not that far in.
No.
But we had to break down what the Republican Party actually is.
We had to go by the 14 points. I mean.
Yeah. So, okay. Okay. So, obviously, we do need to speed up, though. We need to go faster.
All right, let's go.
Okay, so they think the FCC is bad and that they want to go ahead and let the communications companies still give you crappy internet at high fees for no reason other than monopoly, monopoly, monopoly. Money, 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 money. That's what that says. Go ahead and read it. That's page 25. Oy. Okay. America's immigration policy. Okay, so immigration and rule of law. Basically, darky go home, I think is what that really says, isn't it?
Let's see, do a quick skim through.
It's more Talhead.
Oh, okay, okay.
Darky's already here, right, so we're content to beat them down and murder them with our police forces.
We welcome all to the Great Opportunity Party. GOP, the
you're
great.
Cool, that's what GOP stands vote for us.
The great.
That's not what GOP stands for.
Opportunity Party.
GOP.
Oh, well, I've got a name for the episode now. The Great Opportunity Party.
There we go. Thank you, RNC platform. You just named episode part B.
Yeah, I'm gonna put that in real quick. Great Opportunity Party. Go ahead and read on, guys. Read on. Don't make me do it all myself.
Oh, we're back the greatest asset of the American economy is the American worker.
With all our fellow citizens, we have watched in anger and disgust the mocking of our immigration laws by a president who made himself superior to the will of the nation. We stand with the victims of his policies, especially the families of murdered innocents. Illegal immigration endangers everyone, exploits the taxpayers, and insults all who aspire to enter America legally. We oppose any form of amnesty for those who, by breaking the law, have disadvantaged those who have obeyed it.
Oh, really?
Just so people know, the vast, vast majority of people who are, quote-unquote, illegal immigrants in this country are people who actually had legal visas to come here, like student visas, work visas, and everything else, and they have expired.
And they didn't leave.
That's the vast majority.
We oppose any form of amnesty for those who, by breaking the law, have disadvantaged those who have obeyed it. Okay. The letter of that still makes some sense, right?
Yeah, but the problem is I also know somebody who's here not entirely illegally, not entirely legally, who is not actually a citizen of any country. Very interesting what happened with her. Who's
not
going
a citizen
through the
of... process. Any country?
Her parents were Cuban, moved to Switzerland, I believe, had her, but Switzerland doesn't have if you're born in this country, you're a citizen laws.
Really?
Yeah. Your parents actually have to be Swiss.
Oh.
I mean, you can go through a naturalization process, but you're not automatically made a citizen for being born in that country.
Okay.
And so then she moved over here when she was like 6. So she actually is not a citizen of any country.
Neat. Where do you deport her?
Well, no, she's actually going through the process. And like, yeah, I know what this process takes. I've known people who literally have to go through the process, dot every I, cross every T, do everything absolutely correctly, and it takes them over a decade. And thousands of dollars.
Sucky.
Wow, that sucks. Okay. So, yeah. Awesome. Immigration policy. At the end of that section, they, of course, bring up terrorism. Because we didn't have enough fear. To ensure our national security, refugees who cannot be carefully vetted cannot be admitted to the country, especially those whose homelands have been the breeding grounds for terrorism.
Let me bring up a point here, going back to the 2012 and other things about smaller government. If you shrink the size of the government, how in the hell do you think you can carefully vet refugees from countries who may not even a country may not even have records of this person because the building's been destroyed or the records are just never written down in the first place?
We might have even destroyed the building for them.
Yeah. It's the how do you find this information? If you shrink the size of the government, how do you do this? I want an answer.
You simply say no to everyone.
If they said that, then I would respect them, because then that would be an answer.
That's pretty much what they're doing de facto anyway. I love that they actually have the audacity to state that the Supreme Court has correctly recognized anything.
Wow, that's impressive.
Well, no, just that they think that they have the authority to say that the Supreme Court was correct in that, or that
True.
The Supreme Court is incorrect in that, when it's not their job.
Yeah.
You know, the Supreme Court decided. Whether they're correct or not is not up for debate. It's done.
Well, that's a matter of opinion.
Yeah, apparently.
Well, but your opinion matters less than that of the Supreme
exactly.
Court.
Exactly. Those justices' opinions mean more than my opinion, especially on the law.
Yep.
Okay, reforming the treaty system.
This could get interesting.
We intend to restore the treaty system specified by the Constitution.
Oh, yeah?
The President negotiates agreements, submits them to the Senate, with ratification requiring 2/3 of the senators. Only those that are present, though, not all of them. Yeah. This was good enough for George Washington, but it's too restrictive for our current chief executive. Okay.
Now, see, I remember a lot of this happening in reverse, where members of Congress and the Senate would try to do stuff, or would just flat out say, no, I'm sorry, you're not allowed to do that to the president when he was well within his rights.
Yeah,
by the Constitution.
Well, what's happened over the years is that things that were traditionally in the legislative house have been abdicated to the executive. They've essentially given the executive that power, that ability, by not checking it. By not saying that it was worthy to be done.
Later in there, I see where they're going with this. His media admirers portray his personal commitments, whether on climate change, Iranian weapons, or other matters, as done deals.
They are not. And a new Republican executive will work with the Congress to reestablish constitutional order in America's foreign relations.
Oh.
So the fact that we did not send an army into Iran to make sure that they were not using nuclear weapons or building them. Okay.
All international executive agreements and political arrangements entered into by the current administration must be deemed null and void as mere expressions of the current president's preference.
Well, then shouldn't they also nullify and void every treaty entered in previously that was also of the same type?
They won't.
How about all the ones Reagan did?
No. Those are untouchable.
Holy Reagan.
Those are the holy writ. They can't change those. Oh, I'm really looking for good things out of here. I'm having issues, guys.
Oh, but we're about to jump onto the Internal Revenue Service.
Oh, this should be good.
Okay,
let's go.
IRS. Many good civil servants work at the IRS, but the agency itself is toxic.
Ah. Its leadership employs known tax delinquents, rehires workers previously fired for misconduct, spends user fees without congressional oversight, and awards bonuses for customer service that would put any private company out of business. I don't know. Have they heard of Comcast?
Exactly.
Beyond that, the IRS is not exactly a private company.
But it's also not exactly a government agency. It's a weird one.
Yeah, it's in a weird gray area.
It is a government-chartered private company.
It is a quasi-governmental agency, yeah.
Yeah. Which makes it worse because it is IRS.gov.
Yeah.
It systematically targets conservative, pro-life, and libertarian organizations, harassing them with repeated audits and denying their tax-exempt status.
That's because most of those places... There have been a few times where, yes, they did it, and it was very politically motivated by the people who were in charge. I will agree to that, seeing some of the stuff I've seen. However, the vast majority of the times, it's because the people actually aren't able to be classified as pro under, you know, tax exempt status because they're not allowed to be classified as tax exempt. It's not the way the laws are written.
That worst of all, the IRS has become an ideological attack dog for the worst elements of today's Democratic Party. It systematically targets, and libertarian. So they're also, they're trying to lump the Libertarian Party in with the Republican Party. That's definitely the constituents there. But
destroying the IRS folds the whole deck of cards.
Also, as we step down a little bit, we value the right of America's churches, pastors, and religious leaders to preach and speak freely according to their faith.
In other words, you can talk about politics and church.
Yep. Go ahead and proselytize from the pulpit. Go ahead. Politics from the pulpit. Pulpit politics.
Which is done rather frequently. And even if it's not from the pulpit, it's discussed as soon as church is over.
We support repeal of the Johnson Amendment, which restricts First Amendment freedoms of all nonprofit organizations by prohibiting political speech.
And there you have it. They actually come out and say it.
Yeah.
I'll give them a nod for that.
Now, I will agree with the very last sentence they have there. We support making the federal tax code so simple and easy to understand that the IRS becomes obsolete and can be abolished. Not necessarily that part, but the whole, I would love a simplified tax code.
That would be
nice.
I know
a lot of tax preparers who would love a simplified tax code.
That would be very nice. It's not going to happen.
Yeah.
Because then there's less loopholes that the truly super rich can actually dive through.
Well, I mean, there isn't 17,000 pages of tax code because the dude that's on the street freaking homeless wrote himself in a freaking tax exemption
for
buying hair dye.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would really like them to go ahead and do that. I don't think they ever will. That's an empty promise, I think.
It could happen after the Civil War.
Hey, audit the Pentagon! You know, we talked about a story a while ago about auditing the Pentagon and where all that money went away.
Yeah, I'm impressed they're putting it in here, though. I can follow it, but...
It's they put it in as an afterthought. There's one paragraph in here to make it sound like, hey, we're actually going to try to do something to rein in military spending. We're going to do nothing.
It is two sentences. No, three. It is three sentences. Okay.
I love the third sentence.
Whoa. Every taxpayer must be prepared to pass an audit, and we urge Congress to demand the same level of accountability from the Pentagon and the Department of Defense.
I don't know that I'm prepared to pass an audit. I will do it if I have to.
Yeah, no, that's
see, it's the word there. Must versus should.
Mm-hmm.
There's a difference here.
Yeah.
Should be, yes, everyone should be prepared to pass a tax audit. Must be?
Yeah.
What about that small government thing again?
Where's
the organization forcing tax audit preparedness?
Totally gone, man. Totally.
Don't they want the IRS to be abolished?
Yes, they do.
So if the IRS is abolished, there'd be no need to audit anybody.
There'd be nobody to run the audit. Yeah, no major part of the Department of Defense has ever passed an audit. That's because no audit has ever been run, really.
Because a good chunks of the Department of Defense are run on black budget.
Yeah.
Let's be honest here. They're not allowed. It's not the fact they've not passed the audits.
Yeah.
They're not allowed to have audits run on them.
The sun may never shine on those documents. Okay. Improving the federal workforce. We call for renewed efforts to reduce rather than expand government responsibilities, and we urge particular attention to the bloated public relations budgets of the departments and agencies. The federal government spends too much of the people's money telling the people what they should do.
Hold on, you'll love this.
How about just what they do?
As a fan of Edward Snowden, and I know you are, you will love this sentence. We recognize the dedication of most employees of the federal government and thank them for their service, with special praise for the whistleblowers who risk their careers to expose waste, fraud, and misuse of power.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, about that.
Wait, none of them should ever be compelled to join a union or pay dues to it.
Anti-union. union representatives should not be allowed to engage in union-related activities while on the public's time.
No strike.
So the very organizations that would protect a whistleblower.
Yeah.
Or protect
should not
pay,
exist.
Protect, yeah.
The appointees of a Republican president will work with career managers to end these abuses and enforce high standards for all federal employees.
Yeah, I
don't
ever want to deal with a career manager.
I don't see a President Trump doing that.
Well, beyond that, remember, career manager is a wonderful thing. They were called back in the day things like efficiency experts.
Oh, the bots.
Where, why do you have all of these people working for you? You only need half those number to get the job done.
Mm-hmm.
Watch Office Space.
Yeah.
Watch Bob and Bob.
Yeah, the Bobs. Yeah.
That's what a career manager is.
So what would you say you actually do here? Yeah.
Except that they don't find you something that you can do. They just
no.
axe.
Yeah, it's like, that's nice. Okay. We'll be in touch. Pink slip.
Oh, ho.
Advancing
term limits.
Term limits. Okay.
That's interesting.
Go ahead and take it.
Our national platform has repeatedly endorsed term limits for members of Congress. In response, the GOP leadership in 1996 brought to a vote in both the House and Senate a constitutional amendment. It failed to secure the necessary two-thirds vote in the House, where 80% of Republicans voted for it and 80% of Democrats voted against it. Every single Republican voted to allow a vote on term limits. Okay, that word. But Democrats killed it by filibuster. So the Senate Republicans voted to allow a vote. They voted to be able to vote on something.
Okay.
The Democrats said no. This wasn't even a vote for it. It was a vote to be allowed to vote on it. Just so people are out there, yeah, we're having to follow this.
Okay.
Every Senate Republican voted to allow a vote on term limits, but the Democrats killed the filibuster. Blocked by that opposition, Republicans sought other ways to modernize the national legislature. They set term limits for their own committee chairs and leadership positions, and by law they required Congress to live by the same rules it imposed on others. To make further progress to advance a constitutional amendment for consideration by the states, we must expand the current Republican majorities in both chambers. There was a lot of what?
That doesn't say anything. That doesn't say what they're actually for as far as term limits. They just say, yeah, we talked about that.
Yeah, it's essentially, we talked about it. We've talked about talking about it.
Okay. Regulation. The quiet tyranny.
Shh.
It's a quiet tyranny. Overregulation.
They hit the terminology in the first sentence.
Nanny state. It hamstrings American business and hobbles American economic growth. The Great Recession may be over, but in the experience of most Americans, the economy is still sick.
Okay. Yeah, it's because 31 states have
I'm sorry, you broke up there.
Oh, that's because 31 states have Republican governors.
Yeah, that could be it.
I'm in a solidly blue state. It's pretty awesome up here.
Yeah, we're in Florida. God, it sucks.
Yeah, it's
I am sorry.
Yeah. Well, you left us, so you bastard. Okay.
Well, I left for like $10 more an hour.
Yeah, I can't blame you for that. Yeah. The ability of the American people to govern themselves has been undermined by the vast array of agencies with sweeping power to regulate every aspect of American life. Really?
Also, more importantly, please tell me how people can properly govern themselves when your standard farmer might not know the exact functioning and long-reaching capabilities of every single chemical he's putting on his stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
Meh. They'll figure it out. They're smart, dedicated people. They won't do anything to harm the environment that they depend on.
Well, especially when they get rid of the Environmental Protection Agency, which is basically what this is calling to do.
You won't know it's too late until it's a dust bowl.
Wait a second. What's this? We support reinstating the Glass-Steagall Act of 1933.
They talk about get rid of legislations.
This is an interesting paragraph. This whole thing.
I do like the Dodd-Frank law, the Democrats' legislative Godzilla.
Yeah, the Glass-Steagall Act is far more restrictive than Dodd-Frank.
Oh, God, yes. Dodd-Frank was a patchwork tried to cobble together to deal with the holes the repeal of Glass-Steagall caused.
Which was repealed by
Clinton.
And Republicans.
Yeah, but Clinton was the one who signed off on it. He could have
did sign off on it.
Yeah.
We're going to elect another one.
Okay, so that's an interesting one.
I just like the term legislative Godzilla. I'm going to have to remember that one.
Yeah, but then you're quoting them. You really want to do that? I don't know. Okay. Because regulations are just another tax on the consumers, Congress should consider a regulatory budget that would cap the costs of federal agencies that federal agencies could impose on the economy in any given year. So this is...
I know what they're saying there. It's because agencies like the Environmental Protection Agency and everything else can actually issue fines to corporations. What they're saying is the behind-the-scenes thing here is let's make it so whatever fines are issued are so low that the companies can just pay it and not care, and it is cheaper for them to pay the fine than actually fix the problem.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. You know, because you've got power companies that have to have certain scrubbers, and those have been designated by the Environmental Protection Agency what you need to do.
I'll be right back.
As well as for nuclear regulatory agencies, et cetera, blah 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 blah. But those have been put into place to protect the environment from too much outgassing and things.
Yep.
So this, if they bring all that back, they're putting at risk the environment for the short-term economic gain of that company, not the consumer of that company.
Yep.
These are the conversations I get in with my parents and
I really want to hear a more in detailed thing about it, but we don't want your alarm screaming at us again.
It's just bad. Okay, crony capitalism and corporate welfare. Cronyism is inherent in the progressive vision of the administrative state.
Incorrect.
What?
For I just looked this up. Let me pull up the definition again.
Okay.
Cronyism is the appointment of friends and associates to positions of authority without proper regard to their qualifications. I would say this is the exact opposite. The GOP has been very bad about, and changing what it is.
I would say it's inherent in politics.
Progressives are very much about, we might put people we are associated with in there because we know them, but we also know their qualifications. We want this stuff done right.
Yeah, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, the head of the Democratic National Committee. She had to resign today because of certain things that came out in the press, like her emails. And then she was immediately brought on as the chair of Hillary's campaign manager, basically. That's cronyism.
Pure and simple.
Pure and simple, that's cronyism. However,
in going old school, it would be, the old idea, the robber baron having his son take over the steel man, having his son take over the business, even if he's not the most qualified.
Well, that's nepotism.
Yeah.
This would have to be somebody completely unrelated. But still, just a buddy. It's the good old boy system, as we call it down here in the South. But with Wasserman Schultz, she can do the job because she ran her campaign in 2008. So she's already done that job. And based on her emails, she was doing it this whole time too.
Yeah.
So we already know that she can do the job, obviously. So it's not exactly entirely cronyism because, they can, in fact, do the work.
It's cronyistic.
It is cronyistic. When government uses taxpayer funding and resources to give special advantages to private companies, it distorts the free market and erodes public trust in our political system.
once again, going back to something they said earlier, then remove the $8 billion a year we funnel into the oil industry.
Uh-huh.
Be nice.
If you really believe in this stuff, then start actually living by it. Because the moment you do, guys, I will actually start respecting you. Hell, if you do it right, I might actually become Republican again. Very unlikely. But the possibility exists.
They're really... This is definitely the pot calling the kettle black, this whole thing.
Yeah, they're all over the damn place.
I mean, this is... All you have to do is just copy-paste this into the DNC platform, and it's talking about them in the exact same way.
Yeah.
This goes both ways, guys. You're just wrong. This should not be in your platform, because you're attacking something that you do. Good on you if you uphold that and try to get rid of it, but it's disingenuous. So we'll just breeze by.
By enlarging the scope of the government and placing enormous power in the hands of bureaucrats, it multiplies opportunities for corruption and favoritism. It is the enemy of reform in education, the workplace, and healthcare.
Yeah. I can't say they're wrong. It's just disingenuous for them to put it in here because they take way the same advantage that any politician would of this.
They specifically mentioned Solyndra.
What was that one? I can't
recall. That was the solar company that I think Obama gave like $100 million, or it was a fair amount of money, in order to try to advance and push advancement of and production of solar panels and solar technologies, but the company folded, like, within a year or two after.
Oh, okay. I don't know if that's a perfect example or not.
No, it really isn't a perfect example. Because this was, hey, the government is going to give money to a company that's going to try to, you know, help with our energy and try to get us not reliant on OPEC and such like that, not being a part of this and be, quote-unquote, energy independent, which we are. And it just happened to fail. Businesses do that. It was a private business. They fail. If they'd fully nationalized it, it wouldn't have been a problem.
That's true. Yep. We kept that boat afloat. Okay, honoring our relationship with American Indians.
I'm curious to how they go with this. All right.
I would call them Indigenous Americans. But yeah. Okay, so based on both treaty and other law, the federal government has a unique government-to-government relationship with and trust responsibility for Indian tribal governments, American Indians, and Alaskan Natives. These obligations have not been sufficiently honored.
That's entirely true.
Yeah. The social and economic problems that plague Indian country have grown worse over the last several decades. We must reverse that trend. Ineffective federal programs deprive American Indians of the services they need, and long-term failures threaten to undermine tribal sovereignty itself. So, what?
How about we allow them to actually go after people who've committed acts of violence on their territory, and then try them in tribal council? You know, like the people who will go into reservations and rape Native American women because they can then just cross the border out of the reservation and they can't be extradited back into the reservation. This is a thing and a problem.
Yeah. Republicans believe that economic self-sufficiency is the ultimate answer to the challenges confronting Indian country.
Which is short talk for let's give them all casinos.
Wow, it really is, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
You didn't see that? I read that. Like, economic self-sufficiency, give them all casinos.
Yeah, Native communities should have the same authority as state governments in labor matters so that union bosses and the National Labor Relations Board cannot undermine the authority of tribal governments. So we have anti-union rhetoric. The casino thing. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Because what else are they going to do? They can run casinos out there and make lots of money. Moving along, Republicans reject one-size-fits-all approach to federal tribal-state partnerships that will work to expand local authority where tribal governments seek it. Oh, okay, that sounds good. It's true.
Yeah.
Better partnerships will help us expand economic opportunity, deliver top-flight education to future generations, modernize and improve the Indian health service to make it more responsive to local needs, and build essential infrastructure in Indian country in cooperation with tribal neighbors. Okay.
Except do they want to do that, considering most of them run on essentially a socialized health system, or they're part of Medicare or Medicaid?
Yeah, I think most of them are on those.
Because unfortunately, for most people out there, if you've never seen it, take a look at some documentaries about the reservations and where the tribes live, and you'll realize it's some of the poorest countries and poorest communities in the entire United States. Because remember, they weren't given nice land to live on.
To develop their greatest assets, human resources, and the rich natural resources on their lands.
Without undue federal interference. So that is saying, hi, we want to be able to...
We want to drill oil on your land.
We want to have a private company be able to go into Indian territory and go, hi, we're going to pay you 15 seashells. Don't worry, this land doesn't mean anything to you. You won't use it.
I think we're going to need to convert those to shekels, though. That's wrong.
But
wrong.
Again, buying the island of Manhattan, you know, it's that same idea of the, okay, we're going to go in here and we're going to exploit these resources for you and give you a percentage.
Pretty much.
Except read the contract.
Yeah.
There's a reason why most of the First Nations, and that's one of the proper terms for them, is First Nations, for those listeners out there, in Canada and here, like Keystone XL trying to come through their area, and they go, no. And they don't care how much money is handed, they don't care what's given, they're like, no, this is our territory, we're not getting rid of it, we're not selling it, screw you.
Yeah. And then they pander to the American Indians, saying thank you for your military service, which is nice, yeah, it's good. But
well,
I would like to see it in bills that actually support the veterans.
Yep.
You know, put our money where your mouth is. Americans in the territories. That's always contentious.
Which would be interesting, since most of their votes don't count.
Guam, the Commonwealth of Northern Mariana Islands, America, Samoa, and the U.S. Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico. Year after year, citizens quietly, without fanfare, send their sons and daughters into the U.S. Armed Services. Okay, again, more pandering. They started off with pandering that time. We recognize the challenges facing U.S. territories in an era of dramatic global economic change. They need venture capital to retain existing industries and develop new ones. A stronger private sector can reduce dependence on public employment and lead towards self-sufficiency. Their development of local energy options will be crucial to reduce dependency on costly imported fuel. Okay, again, oil.
Yeah.
And we're going to take it to the private industry. We don't want government hands in that at all.
Because remember,
in fact, we're going to abandon you, is what that says.
The private industry can solve all problems.
That's pretty much this part of the platform, yeah.
What I'm not seeing in any of this section is anything involving, allowing them to have more vote and say, allowing them to have more of the actual rights shared by standard Americans. The right for them to be actually citizens, come in some of these, they aren't even considered citizens. They're in a weird legal gray area.
This is interesting, though. We call for the appointment of a Commonwealth and Territories Advisory Committee consisting of representatives from all five U.S. territories.
Is that government growth?
It's a committee.
Is that growing the government?
I don't know. It's a committee.
Yeah, but they're going to have staff to bring all the paperwork in.
That's true.
And to go and, you know, on the islands. And, yeah, I mean,
and they're putting it into the president's tradition team. So they're making the executive branch bigger. That's not something they ever want to do. Why are they doing that? Huh. We further
the
call
is
for
it's
the
also not anything to do with the president. That's not part of the executive.
We further call for the appointment of a special assistant to the president responsible for day-to-day interaction with the territories and commonwealths. Okay.
Yeah.
Why? Why is that even necessary? Just make them states already or something.
Yeah. Speaking of which, the first sentence in their section on the territory of Puerto Rico.
We support the right of the United States citizens of Puerto Rico to be admitted to the Union as a fully sovereign state.
Aha.
Okay. That's progress. Now, if they will only vote for it.
Yeah.
We further recognize the historic significance of the 2012 local referendum, in which a 54% majority voted to end Puerto Rico's current status as a U.S. territory, and 61% chose statehood over other options for sovereignty. Okay, why didn't they end up making it a state, though?
Because it was only a referendum. It was referendum votes in this country are just the, hey, what do you think of this idea? They don't actually mean a thing beyond that.
Hmm.
See, we want to see what your opinion is, and instead of conducting a poll from a call center, we're going to have a vote.
Now it has to be ratified. Yeah, Congress should approve enabling act with terms for Puerto Rico's future admission as the 51st state of the Union. Okay, great. Love it. I think that's probably going to be in the Democratic Party, too. It's just up for them to do it. I think we're ready for that now. We're just going to have to change a lot of flags. It's going to be a lot of paint. A lot of paint jobs. A lot of flag work. Okay, preserving the District of Columbia. Washington, D.C. The nation's capital is a special responsibility of the federal government because it belongs both to its residents and to all Americans, millions of whom visit it every year. Congressional Republicans have fostered home ownership and open access to higher education for Washington residents. Against the opposition of the current president and leaders of the Democratic Party, they have established and expanded the D.C. Opportunity Scholarship Program, through which thousands of low-income children have been able to attend school of their choice and receive a quality education. Privatize education with vouchers. Here, we're doing it in D.C. and it works. Here, try this. We can get away with it because it doesn't have its own little government kind of thing.
Yeah. Also remember, when it comes to D.C., everything that city tries to do has to be approved by Congress.
Yeah.
So the mayor wants an initiative done. We try this whole thing. Yay, we go out there and try this. And Congress goes, no.
Yeah.
So they can't.
We expect Congress to assert by whatever means necessary its constitutional prerogatives regarding the district. Right.
It should become its own special zone and just here.
Yeah. Since the Supreme Court's decisions affirming the Second Amendment rights of its citizens, city officials have engaged in a campaign of massive resistance by denying virtually all applications for gun ownership. The Republican Congress should be prepared upon the inauguration of a Republican president to enact legislation allowing law-abiding Washingtonians to own and carry firearms.
Yeah, if I remember
correctly, Secret Service is not big on that, I don't think.
Beyond that, if I remember correctly, let me actually see if I can pull this up. Okay, that's Council Pro Tem. Not seeing anything involving actually what their parties are. So I cannot say for certain, sadly. But given things that I've seen about, yes, we want to have all this capability. We want to have all these.
Ooh. Okay. Statehood for the district can be advanced only by a constitutional amendment. Any other approach would be invalid. A statehood amendment was soundly rejected by the states when last proposed in 1976 and should not be revived. no, we're going to keep DC under our thumb. Go away.
Yeah.
That's that paragraph. Okay. We are on to a new whole section.
Hey, we're at page 31.
Bum, bum, bum. And there was much rejoicing. No, there's not much rejoicing.
So we're now on to the Great American Families, Education, Healthcare, and Criminal Justice.
Welcome back, David. We've just moved on to a new section.
Oh, good Lord.
The Great American Families, Education, Healthcare, and Criminal Justice section, starting with American values. We are the party of independent individuals and the institutions they create together. Families, schools, congregations, neighborhoods, to advance their ideals and make real their dreams.
As long as they do it themselves.
That sounds good, though. That sounds good. That's got a good ring to it.
Yeah.
Good writing there. Good writing. So that's probably cover for baloney.
Those institutions standing between the citizen and the power of government are the pillars of a free society.
Wait, what?
Yeah. That's the next sentence.
That's the very next sentence?
That's the very next sentence.
Those institutions.
Like I shot a fireball just because of how idiotic that sentence actually was.
Okay. Those institutions standing between the citizens and the power of government are the pillars of free society. So families, schools, congregations, and neighborhoods are standing between citizens and government to keep them free.
But remember, they create spaces where the power of government should not intrude. They allow Americans to work together to solve most of the problems facing their communities. Thus, they thus reduce the need for intervention by government in the form of more and bigger problems or a larger public workforce.
Okay. I would like to just do a little quick thought experiment here.
I'm ready.
If there's a small island, say you've got 2,000 people on the island, okay? We've got places like that, even in the United States. Say those people have no government whatsoever, okay? But they still live, they still work, they still do these things, but there's no government involved. And then they realize that nobody wants to take the trash to the dump. And, you know, they don't think that they should do that. So eventually they kind of get together and, oh, look, there's maybe a guy. You know, says, hey, there's a business opportunity there. Cool. And he starts that service. Starts then charging everybody for that service. Eventually, they might congregate together and maybe want the same price for said service. Because maybe he's charging by the mile. Eventually, that will then get put into a government. These little service agencies, you know. Trash pickup, municipal waste. And what about the roads that he's then been tearing up with his horse and buggy or something? Whatever it is.
Or well, beyond that.
Eventually, those are going to have to get fixed.
Let's go to the older version.
You know,
Somebody decides not to pay him. How does he seek recompense?
Yeah. Well, he goes with a baseball bat, obviously. But we can't
or
have
hires,
people.
Hires
we can't
a
have
local
people.
Muscle.
Yeah, but we can't have people doing that. That's anarchy.
Hey, another business opportunity.
That's right. That's right. That's the free market, ladies and gentlemen, at work. Is that the kind of free market you want?
Freedom and services always come at the point of a gun. Always. Whether that gun is something that you actually have some say in or not depends on whether or not you have a government or not. There are service providers in Somalia.
Yeah. But
if you do not pay them, they will kill you and your family.
Yeah. But do you, as an American citizen, want to go down that route?
Obviously.
Apparently, as a Republican or as a Libertarian, yeah, that's your jam, man. That's exactly what you want to do. And maybe that's why they have all the guns.
Yeah, because they know exactly where that society is going to lead. Which is why I need to buy more.
Yep.
I need my automated turrets. Okay. Our society is at a crossroads. For several generations, an expensive federal regime has marginalized and supplanted the institutions holding our society together.
Really? Can anybody else love, again, I love how words are used and how wordplay is done.
Yeah.
The federal regime. Regime is never used for a good thing. Regime is the South American Colombian dictator who's murdering peasants to make his cocaine, or the warlord in Africa. It's never a good thing. Just think about word usage sometime out there, citizens. Listen to how people talk. Listen to how media talks.
Yep.
Listen to things like this. And just think of how meaning words have and the fact of why they use that word instead of something else.
The cornerstone of the family is natural marriage, the union of one man and one woman. There's no such thing as natural marriage.
Entirely correct. I was about to bring that up. Thank you, David.
Yeah, there is only natural breeding.
Yeah.
That is it.
Have you met
marriage
my breeding partner?
Marriage is an institution which is implemented purely on a sociological plane.
Yeah.
Has nothing to do with nature.
It's a business arrangement, technically.
It's for tax purposes.
Hey, if we get rid of the IRS, can we get rid of marriage?
Ooh.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Work.
I don't know. They also say that strong families, depending upon God and one another, advance the cause of liberty by lessening the need for government in their daily lives.
Of course.
Let's outsource it to God. That's free market, right?
Figure out that it lessens the need of government in their lives, and yet look at all the things that happen government-wise, a lot of these policies advocated by the GOP that you're required to do once you're married. Yeah.
Okay, so they're thinking that the whole, you know, lack of the traditional, you know, 1950s style traditional American marriage, you know, woman, man, 2.3 children and a dog, white picket fence, nuclear family, that kind of thing.
You mean the family that had a minimum wage high enough to live on?
Yeah, single income too, where mom stayed home, you know, and dad was the breadwinner, you know.
Yep.
Banging all the skirts at the office, that kind of thing. We have learned over the last five decades, apparently, that the loss of faith and family life leads to greater dependence upon government. And that is why Republicans formulate public policy from taxation to education, from healthcare to welfare, with attention to the needs and strengths of the family.
I would like to bring up, as we have several times on this show, that whole thing of the loss of faith and family life leads to greater dependence upon the government, and yet the greatest consumers of the welfare system, be it food stamps, be it everything else, are in the Bible Belt, where God rules supreme.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All of which give us these truths about traditional marriage. Children raised in a two-parent household tend to be physically and emotionally healthier, more likely to do well in school, less likely to use drugs and alcohol, engage in crime, or become pregnant outside of marriage.
Well, the funny thing is, with the way they stated that right there, I will kind of agree. Because they say children raised in a two-parent household, not children raised with a man and a wife.
That's true. Yes.
I'm going, aha.
I like that. Yeah. But, you know, our current president was raised by a single mother.
Oh, yeah.
So I think he turned out okay because he became president and all.
Smart dude.
That's
but I just love
better than I'm doing.
There.
Oh. Okay.
You know who really are unlikely to become pregnant outside of marriage? Gay people.
They're very unlikely. Yeah, that's true. That's true.
If it happens, it's clearly a miracle, and God meant for that to happen.
Okay, so this is basically welfare bad. Family good, welfare bad. So we must strengthen the family to prevent more welfare. Something like that.
But if they don't have enough to eat, that's obviously not going to destroy the family.
Well, yeah. Those might have been the 40% of children who are now born outside of marriage or something. It's their fault for being done born.
Obviously.
Been born. Yeah, something like that. Okay. This kind of makes me throw up a little bit in my mouth.
But we have a culture of hope.
A culture of hope. Ouch, and a sharps. Those are in my shoulder. Okay, ow. I got a podcat.
You really need that pauldron.
I got a podcat. Yeah, I need shoulder pads. Big, puffy shoulder pads.
You need just one. He seems to really favor that left side.
This is where he goes. He will not be on the right shoulder. That's not right. No, so he will only be on the left shoulder.
So what you're saying is you have a left-leaning cat.
He's a lefty, I guess. Yeah. Well, actually, no, he's right-handed, so he wants his right hand able to swat at things to keep them away from me.
Hmm.
I think. I don't know. But, yeah, it ends up he's on my left shoulder. So, a culture of hope. We've been fighting the war on poverty for 50 years, and poverty is winning.
It really took off in the last 30 since Reaganomics.
Why are we continuing to wage war against an existential entity?
Because it's the only way we as Americans know how to deal with things.
There's
war.
It's not war.
I'm going to shoot poverty in the face.
Boom.
That
headshot.
That might work, but it's an existential... Ah! You can't. That's not how this works.
It's not how any of this works.
It's not how any of this works. Oh, okay. So something about
verb.
This year marks another important anniversary, as it's been 20 years since the landmark Republican welfare reform of 1996 broke away from the discredited Great Society model. The discredited Great Society model?
Yeah, it's not discredited considering...
Was it ever discredited?
It worked.
Aren't we still riding on the Great Society?
We were doing great on the Great Society model.
Okay. By making welfare a benefit instead of an entitlement, it put millions of recipients on a transition from dependence to independence. Welfare rolls declined by half as recipients and prospective recipients discovered a better way to reach their goals. And
well, in truth, as we know what happened, it just, they kicked them off.
And made it so hard to get on it that their numbers went down.
You either starve or you starve slower.
Yeah. It's just funny numbers. Best of all, about 3 million children moved out of poverty. That's because they grew up into adults and then were no longer eligible for the same care.
Yeah, more children have moved into poverty since.
Yeah, they've been replaced, but yeah. Today, that progress has been lost. Okay. Right. Temporary assistance for needy families. This decision ensures that those families will remain needy and cut off from economic mainstream of American society. Really?
Just remember this. This is the progressive pathology.
Yeah.
Keeping people dependent so that government can redistribute income.
But...
No.
No.
Not even close. As a matter of fact, almost everybody who actually goes on TANF... actually gets off of it within a year or two or three.
Yeah.
The vast majority need temporary assistance. Yeah, it might not be for 3 months. It might be I need it for a few years.
It's in the name, though. Yeah.
And they eventually are able to quite easily get off it. It's just, again, sometimes the job I need is 4 states away, and I can't afford to move there.
Yeah. Because all the jobs left.
Yeah.
Like the carrier plant to Mexico.
Yeah.
Or Oreos to Mexico.
Oreos to Mexico.
Yeah.
Probably right next to the carrier plant.
Maybe they're in the same plant.
Are they going to smell of... Are carrier systems not going to smell of Oreos?
That would be... That wouldn't be bad. Wouldn't be bad. Maybe when it dies here, you know. The result is 45.8 million people on food stamps and 77 million on Medicaid, plus another 5.7 million in the Children's Health Insurance Program. which is free for those that don't have health insurance. The children's health insurance program.
77 million on Medicaid because insurance premiums and prices are so high, most people can't afford it.
Yeah.
45.8 million people on food stamps because the amount they're getting paid is so low, they can't put food on the table. And places like Walmart hand out a here's how you apply for welfare to people who start working for them.
Yeah. The false compassion of the status quo. We propose instead. Okay, here's how they're going to fix it. Okay, we propose instead the dynamic compassion of work requirements in a growing economy, where opportunity takes the place of a handout, where true self-esteem can grow from the satisfaction of a job well done.
That's great.
This is the Baron Munchausen bootstrap yourself up.
Well, but I also look at this and I go, okay, this idea is great. Then fine.
That's not an idea, though. That's not an idea.
Yeah, no, but it's also, where are the opportunities? You want to give them the opportunity? Fine. Where's the opportunity?
That
is not... Because most of these opportunities will be the government going, hi, let me help you.
We call for the removal of structural impediments which progressives throw in the path of poor people. What?
Well, oh, okay. Let's have a list of what those structural impediments are.
Okay, overregulation of startup enterprises, excessive licensing requirements, needless restrictions on formations of schools and daycare centers serving neighborhood families. Pesky things like regulation of that. Because we don't want our children to be taken care of properly in a nice, safe environment with people that know how to drive the bus and things like that. We don't want any of that. And restrictions on providing public services in fields like transportation or, sanitation. Because cholera, that little thing, no, that's fine. That's fine. We're fine with that.
If they want to remove those restrictions, then I will do I will do what was done back in the day, back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, some in the 80s. I will honestly, because I know they will get the job done right, I will invite organized crime into every state and go, hi, you guys run sanitation because I know you'll do it right. Because you want us to keep paying you and you're going to make sure we don't die.
Yeah, that's how it works.
That's how it should work.
Yeah.
It's funny that organized criminals actually understand this better than these people.
Well,
what's going on?
Sometimes crime does pay. Your mic's up. There you go. Oh, well, we're just looking at the culture of hope that the GOP would like to foster here. So they call to get people off of welfare. They're calling to for the removal of structural impediments. You know, the overregulation of startup enterprises, excessive licensing requirements, the needless restrictions on the formations of schools and daycare centers, you know, serving the neighborhood families. You know, the things that would, like, keep children safe. You know, like the number of children to one adult and things like that.
Don't you get it, Andy? The reason why there's poor people is because they haven't been able to start their own business.
That's what they're saying. Yeah. We propose instead of dynamic compassion, we propose instead the dynamic compassion of work requirements in a growing economy. This is the, you know, as I've said earlier, the Baron Munchausen pulling yourself up by your own bootstraps kind of mentality, which doesn't work. But
start your business with nothing. And in 90 days, you'll be Warren Buffett. Works 100% of the time.
For 0% of the people.
Don't read the fine print, Andy.
Don't read the fine print. Don't read the fine print. We will continue to fight for school choice until all parents can find good, safe schools for their children. You know, the ones that are regulated, maybe. To protect
the ones with armed guards in them?
Right. To protect religious liberty, we will ensure that faith-based institutions, especially those that are vital parts of underserved neighborhoods, do not face discrimination by government.
Huh.
let's make a specific thing here about that is, again, people forget, and I brought this up before, I think, schools are paid for via property tax. And right. The majority of the schools that have a problem and budget issues, it's because the vast majority of people there are renting and unable to afford actual housing, which means they don't pay any property tax.
That's right, yeah. So then it's only the apartment complex that is basically paying the property tax, and they manage to get through on several loopholes because of whatever maybe they're doing. They're doing government-assisted housing, perhaps, in the truly lower-class neighborhoods, mm-hmm. and then they get a benefit to their property taxes based on that. They might not pay any property tax at all because they're offering those programs, mm-hmm. which only serves to hurt the neighborhoods with children.
Yeah, it's the whole idea of the, okay, there might be 200 people living in this apartment building, 200 families in this apartment building.
Yeah.
Okay, rather than 200 individual houses and 200 individual groups of people paying property tax, you've right. got one.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Which is why the schools in suburbs typically are higher performing than those that are inner city.
Also because the schools in the suburbs tend to be filled with people who actually can eat breakfast because their family can afford it.
Or any number of things.
Yeah.
You know, getting 3 square meals instead of the government-assisted free breakfast is also a thing. You know, that's happening even in schools that aren't like Title II, where they're, you know, taking in a lower income and constituency. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Continuing.
Education. Still in education. A chance for every child. For every child. Yes. Oh, it's for every child now. Education is much more than schooling.
Agreed. It's also like recess, which I've shown is very important to kids.
Yeah, just ask Jaden Smith about school.
What happened with Jaden Smith? I'm not.
Oh, his tweets are amazing. I think the quote goes something like, "If nobody went to school, we'd have a much better educated society." I believe is the quote.
Oh God. Okay. Well, he's also embroiled into Scientology along with his father, so there's a lot to unpack there.
Oh, here we go. If everybody in the world dropped out of school, we would have a much more intelligent society.
Can we please just drop him off? And I don't mean this because he's black. Can we literally just drop him off in the middle of an African village, or better yet, Somalia?
Just in the middle of the outback. Let the snakes take care of him. Okay.
Well, he'd be among intelligent people, that's for sure.
He would, yeah. Okay. I think you're insulting snakes, though. Okay. It is the whole range of activities by which families and communities transmit to a younger generation not just knowledge and skills, but ethical and behavioral norms and traditions. Don't be different, people. Don't be different. If you're different, you're anathema.
It is the handing over of a cultural identity. As the very next sentence.
The handing over of cultural identity. That is why American education has, for the last several decades, been the focus of constant controversy, as centralizing forces from outside the family and community have sought to remake education in order to remake America. They have done immense damage.
I don't want to be surrounded by a bunch of idiots who don't know shit.
Yeah, well, apparently we're doing immense damage by, you know, teaching things like birth control and, you know, proper sex education and history and
evolution
and art and things of that nature. Yeah. Oh, the science. Woo, the science. The federal government shouldn't. Yeah. The federal government should not be a partner in that effort, as the Constitution gives it no role in education. They want to take it all away. They want to completely privatize all education.
I will agree. The Constitution does not give the federal government a role in education, because back then most schooling was done in the home or on a small little, you know, semi-private little area in the town. Lost little house on the prairie and stuff like that. That's how education was done. We've gone so far beyond that, though, and it is now part of the common good that the federal government needs a hand in this. Because if we want to be competitive on a global platform...
We support a constitutional amendment to protect that right from interference by states, the federal government, or international bodies such as the United Nations. We reject a one-size-fits-all approach to education and support a broad range of choices for parents and children at the state and local level. We likewise repeat our long-standing opposition to the imposition of national standards and assessments.
Well, good luck with the Bushes, because they're the ones that really drove the testing, mandated testing of everybody.
Yeah. They hate Common Core, because they mention it right here. Congratulate states that have successfully repealed it.
I'm not sure that there's many people who actually like Common Core.
Actually, a lot of teachers like Common Core.
Really?
Yes. Absolutely. And
they've had to relearn how to do certain things because of how it's done. But
the reasoning is sound because it actually builds on each other. So the techniques that you learn in the lower grade levels are then also built upon in concept. So you're actually not just learning the content, you're learning how to think about the content.
And also the idea is simply you're in, say, Massachusetts doing Common Core.
That's the thing.
And then you move to, say, Wyoming doing Common Core, your education doesn't change.
That is my biggest argument for it.
I do like that.
Because we're one nation.
I understand why they're against Common Core now.
Yeah, it normalizes across the board. Education here is the same as education here is the same as education here.
Because then individual states that cannot perform, like Louisiana and
Kansas.
Well, some Kansas, it's okay because a lot of the class sizes are so small anyway. What's that?
Florida.
Yeah, Florida's. They have to give it a chance for one.
No, we don't do that in this country.
Yeah, you don't know if it's going to work.
We change the entire course of our education system every couple of years.
Yeah.
Yeah, which means that children get left hanging right in the middle.
They just get a completely random mash of whatever happened to be.
Yeah. Now, I am fortunate here in that my children have started public education with Common Core. They're not having to relearn something, you know, and backstamp it, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Which also wasn't exactly happening, by the way. They were phasing it in over the course of time to let children and also teachers adapt slightly. Some of the teachers were really having a big hard time with it, but that's also because they had to then learn a new way to teach.
Yeah.
But once they did, many of the ones that are good teachers have actually adapted to it and realized the benefits to it and can then carry on. I've had it explained to me a few times.
What I also find hilarious is the people who scream against Common Core Math, and I've looked at Common Core Math problems, especially the low-level ones, like, you know, hi, can you do basic math according to Common Core? And I looked at it, really analyzed it, and I realized what they're doing is exactly what they planned on doing with Common Core Math, which figure out how most people actually think of math in their brains and how it works. And I analyzed it, and I went, yeah, I've taught how to do standard paper, do the standard trees, you know, blah, blah, multiply, that.
Yeah.
But I looked at how it was in Common Core, and I went, no, that's actually a slightly slower version and more thought-out version of how I actually think.
Yeah.
And how I mentally break down the problem in my mind. I just do it so much faster now because I've been doing it for years that way.
Exactly.
I did it a slightly different way than Common Core.
Yeah, I did too. But I was also, I don't know when I started changing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I don't know when that became my thought process and it has now always been my thought process. So these educators that actually came up with the requirements for Common Core and the methodology, they have studied this. You know, the behavioral psychologists, they've looked at this. This is their job. This is their career. They're the scientists behind it. And so far, so good.
Mm-hmm.
You got to let it ride, though. And, well, we're very impatient. We're very impatient. But also, this would mean that people that have gone through a charter school that is not doing Common Core math because they're not required to by the state or any particular agency, if those children then come out of that and then go into the public school, how doomed do you think that child's going to be?
Yeah.
They're going to be so screwed. It is better for the children to grow up in an environment where if you change schools, now this affects the low income earners that are very transient. It affects them more than anyone else because what are they doing? They're following money, which is one of the things that they want them to do. They want the GOP would like you to go ahead and just, well, if there's no jobs there, then you need to move and go follow the jobs. Okay, they do that. But then they have children. They're bringing those children into that community. And if the education system is vastly different, you do a disservice to the children that are coming in and leaving and going in and out of these school systems. To just be able to pick up right where they left off anywhere in the country. That's valuable. And to say otherwise, I think, is ignorant.
Yeah, just think of all the military kids.
Oh, yeah.
Andy, going further down this section.
Yes, please get me off my tirade.
Skimming through. No, you'll. I was about to say you'll love this, but no, you'll probably start bleeding from the eyes, and the screen will go red. A good understanding of the Bible is being indispensable for the development of an educated citizenry. We encourage state legislatures to offer the Bible in a literature curriculum as an elective in American high schools.
As a literature?
It's the first section that gets me. A good understanding of the Bible being indispensable for the development of an educated citizenry. Now, a literature elective? That's fine. As a literature book, sure.
We encourage state legislatures, to offer the Bible as a literature curriculum as an elective in America's high schools.
I am against this.
I think that would be fine if it was in a comparative religions course.
If they're going to cover all religions, absolutely. But yeah. They already have world religions in high school.
I didn't. That wasn't at our high school.
Technically speaking, they do. You're part of it's not the AP program anymore, but if you're going and taking actual AA degree classes while in high school.
Yeah, but the problem is you're talking about an incredibly small subset of the overall populace.
That's not general population. No.
It needs to be. You should come out of high school with an associate's degree. That's a bare minimum now to get a kind of decent paying job out of high school.
But that doesn't happen. I don't know anyone that comes out of high school with an AA.
My niece did.
Okay.
Yeah, I've known a couple, but it's the ones who are the.
But how many
so
other people?
High-performing how many other they're people already taking college did? Classes halfway through high school, anyways.
Yeah, how many other people in her school did?
I had a classmate actually in 2001 that graduated with their AA degree.
So you had one?
Yeah, I had one.
How many were in your class?
360 some.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I rest my case.
Yeah.
That's rare. That's rare.
It's rare because we make it rare. But, I mean, an Associate of Arts degree is basically the 13th grade. You're doing more math.
It takes 2 years to do it, though.
It can be done in one.
If you do absolutely nothing else. But usually by that time, people have to go out and get a job.
Right.
And depending on the way they're offered.
Public education system.
Ah, there's the problem.
Aha! Aha! Yes, well, it's not. Not yet. And it certainly won't be under this platform. Okay, so... and then they berate the tenured system approach for a merit system approach, which, okay, fine. But, you know, you're still not attracting anybody that wants to teach.
Yeah.
And I think that the A needs to be put back in STEM for STEAM. add the arts back in.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Science,
technology.
It's
being shown more and more it's actually required and makes for a more well-rounded person.
Yeah.
Able to, you know, think creatively.
Shop class is not a bad idea either. Teach kids how to change their own tires, do some basic auto repair.
I have no idea how much I wish I'd had a shop class. My high school had offered a shop class, and if they'd offered it, how much I would have taken it, because I would love to be able to do more than just the very basic things I've done to my freaking car.
For my high school career, it was no longer an option by 1995. It was gone. There was a very strong showing in auto shop. That was there, and then, by the end of school year 1995, you know, right going into that summer, it was gone. It was pulled. The following year, wood shop was pulled.
Oh, they still had wood shop in 01.
No, it came back.
Oh,
it was gone for me. Yeah.
Aw.
Yeah. So, as you can tell, David and I went to the same high school. So yeah, it went away.
This is why we're bitter about our education.
We are maybe a little bitter about it. Maybe a little. And it wasn't a bad high school either. And we're still bitter.
They did have some interesting ideas come out of there, like the four-day rule, which they did in 2000, and the school board yanked in 2001.
Four-day rule?
Yeah. If you had missed less than 4 days of class, and you had a B or better in that class, you did not have to take the final exam.
Ooh.
Grades and attendance went through the roof.
Yeah, that means you get people wanting to really study and be there.
Yeah, no, they put a carrot on the stick instead
of...
Yeah, your grade's enough. That's enough to motivate you.
You clearly know what you're doing. Cool, go.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I hadn't heard about that.
Yeah, no, I miss... Like, I went to school... I was so sick, but I was like, I'm missing less than my 4 days because I'm doing really well in all my classes. And then the next year they took it away. The school board was really upset, and they put the kibosh on that. And so my senior class did their protest of, yeah, we're going to miss 9 days of school because we can without failing.
So
because you've taken away this amazing carrot on the stick that we fought through hell and high water to obtain.
Mm-hmm.
It should have been a teaching moment for the leadership of schools. Instead, it was, nope, thumb, ba-boom.
Yeah, they want that test back. They needed the metrics more than they needed people to actually pass. Okay, so on to academic excellence for all. I will sum up with saying that it's, again, a choice in education, building on the basic, you know, STEM whatever, and also having the ability to change school and go to a charter or something or whatever and seek your own path. Which is not your own path, it's your parents' path. Whatever your parents want to put you in, that's what they're going to put you in. You know, I just want to point that out. For those of you that are now adults and listening to this, would you have trusted completely your parents choosing your education choice? Or does that terrify you at this moment in time?
Totally against this ideal.
Completely. It's a little scary, isn't it?
I was allowed to actually make choices in high school for classes and everything else. My parents actually gave me a lot of freedom and allowed me to screw myself up if that was what I chose to do. So I'm glad they could do that, but I know a lot of people who were very dealing with helicopter issues.
Well, no. I'm talking about the parents that would have pulled you out of public school and put you into Catholic school.
I went the exact opposite route. I started in Catholic school, and they yanked me and put me in public school because of what the Catholic school was doing.
I maintained private school all the way until I hit college.
You were in private school?
Yep.
Was it good?
It was decent, but the more I look back on it now, I go, again, I was raised Southern Baptist, not by my parents, but by the school. The school was higher rated than the local public school, because it was here. And then I chose to go to a Catholic high school. My parents gave me the choice. I could have gone to the public one. I would have ended up killing somebody if I'd gone to the public school.
Well, that's for another show, I think. Yeah. Okay. So, again, but this is their path. This is what they've chosen. They want to continue to put people into choice schools, and basically, again, do away with the public education system entirely. But to focus on needing it greatly. We really need education, but we want it to be private. We want people to do it, you know, as part of the economy.
Pay for it yourself.
Pay for it yourself. But we desperately need it, so we encourage you to go do it.
Yep. But if you happen to live in a disadvantaged community, you're not going to get any assistance to do so.
Yeah. And then the entire next section is just more doubling down on that, the choice in education. So we'll just move along. Title IX.
One section on there I want to actually mention.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
It's the last paragraph on the right column. We renew our call for replacing, quote-unquote, family planning programs for teens with sexual risk avoidance education that sets abstinence until marriage as the responsible and respected standard of behavior.
Oh, no. They're...
That approach, the only one always effective against premarital pregnancy. I'm sorry, right there. I have to call them on that. I have to absolutely call them the only one always effective against premarital pregnancy. Because of the amount of times they mention God and they allude to Christianity in here, they have to say, by their own mythology, that doesn't apply and is entirely incorrect.
Oh.
By their own mythology, they know it's happened at least once.
Hey, guys. English first approach. Also. You will learn English in this country.
Yeah.
Which is fine, but we don't have a national language.
Well, more importantly, let's look at other countries and even schools here which teach, even starting at a young age, other languages. Their kids tend to be more socially adapted, smarter, and also able to get better jobs as they get older because their brain is already adapted and designed to handle multiple conflicting situations.
Yeah, it is definitely beneficial. And they're saying that it's a divisive program that may limit students' ability to advance in American society.
They also oppose school-based clinics that provide referral or counseling for abortion and contraception and believe that federal funds should not be used in mandatory or universal
mental health,
psychiatric, or socio-emotional screening programs.
Because that would keep guns out of the hands of people who shouldn't have them.
Well, by a knockdown effect, I guess, but why would we not want people to get psychiatric care? I can't come up with a good argument that is any at all acceptable.
Yeah.
Because it would destroy their voter base.
Oh, you think it's just about twisting people into away from this ideology?
Because we all know what's going to happen is they're going to say that being a conservative is a psychiatric condition and thus needs to be treated.
Well, it technically is.
The thing is, I've actually heard that.
It technically is, though. Literally, conservative and liberal minds are wired differently and perceive things such as fear.
Oh, no, we know. We've covered this three or four times. Yeah, no, we know. Yeah, the way they operate is different, but they're not mental health disorders. However,
well, they run on fear. So the fear is that they could be classified as a mental disorder.
Yeah, true. Oh, gods, really?
Yep. Title IX.
Yeah, we emphatically support the original, authentic meaning of Title IX of the Education Amendments of 1972. It affirmed that, quote, no person in the United States shall, on the basis of sex, be excluded from participation in, be denied the benefits of, or be subject to discrimination under any education program or activity receiving federal financial assistance. That language opened up for girls and women a world of opportunities that has too often been denied to them. That same provision of law is now being used by bureaucrats and the current president of the United States to impose a social and cultural revolution. God, I love the fact they threw that in there. Upon the American people by wrongly redefining sex discrimination to include sexual orientation or other categories. Their agenda has nothing to do with individual rights. It has everything to do with power. They are determined to reshape our schools and our entire society to fit the mold of an ideology alien to America's history and traditions.
Their America's a melting pot.
Yeah, their edict to the states concerning restrooms, locker rooms, and other facilities is at once illegal, dangerous, and ignores privacy issues. We salute the several states which have filed suit against it. Let that sink in. For everyone out there who's listening, just let that... If it's not going to cause too much pain or an aneurysm, let it...
I'm getting twitchy.
I opened up an Amazon page in self-defense. Just so I can see objects that are not this page.
That's fair.
Oh, God! We need shinies! Okay, we need to move on.
Hey, look, here's all my zombie apocalypse gear that I'm going to buy so I can survive Trump.
Yeah, you're going to need it.
I mean, the apocalypse.
The zombie apocalypse. Trumpocalypse. Yeah, okay, so that's all bad. Basically, we want the right to continue to discriminate against things that are weird to us. That's basically what
that we define as weird.
Yeah, that are traditionally weird. The traditional, all traditional, you know, natural weirdness. Improving higher education. I'm not sure what they want to do there. Let's see.
Get government funding out of it and rip down the institutions because they promote liberal thought.
We condemn the campus-based boycott, divestment, and sanctions campaign against Israel. It is anti-Semitism and should be denounced by advocates of academic freedom.
Yes,
oh, this is safe zones.
You have a problem with, you know, the Israelis launching campaigns and, you know, annihilating whole neighborhoods in Palestinian areas, or not clamping down on settlers going into and illegally settling in Palestinian areas. Clearly, I'm an anti-Semite.
Clearly.
Whatever the solution may be, in private institutions, in state schools, and the trustees have a responsibility to the taxpayers to ensure that their enormous investment is not abused for political indoctrination. This is, of course, a problem because the higher education that you actually receive, the more often you become a liberal.
Again, the more you learn, the more you realize most of what you're being told is complete bullshit. And more importantly, you get to do, once you get more educated, you are taught and you typically do the one thing that most of these hardcore people can't stand you doing. Question.
Yeah.
You question authority. You question... not just authority, but why are you an authority? And this scares them.
Then we get into college costs.
Yeah, I tried to do a quick read through this, and some of this I agree with.
Yeah, I mean, it's true.
However,
it is very difficult to maintain. What'd you find?
They talk about, you know, student debt, going over credit card debt, the fact that delinquency rates on student loans are as high as subprime mortgages in the housing crisis. I'm like, okay, I can agree with it. Almost over half of recent college grads are unemployed or underemployed. I'm like, okay, that's fair. We get to we need new systems of learning to compete with traditional four-year schools, technical institutions, online universities, lifelong learning, and work-based programs in the private sector. Public policy should advance their affordability, innovation, and transparency, and should recognize that a four-year degree from a brick-and-mortar institution is not the only path toward a prosperous and fulfilling career. The federal government should not be in the business of originating student loans. AKA, you can't take the lower interest rate thing from the government. You have to take the higher interest rate thing from a private organization. And I agree. I would love to see more technical institutions, more other things, because there are people out there who, really, college isn't for them. Going into an actual tech program would be where they would need to go. However.
Yeah, and this is where it gets weird, because they're talking about accrediting and accrediting bodies. They're thinking this model would foster innovation, bring private industry into the credentialing market. Trump University.
Pat Robertson University.
I'm just going to leave it there. Just That's all we really need, right?
Yeah.
Oh. Restoring patient control and preserving quality in healthcare. Why is this section even in here?
It's there to...
Oh, it's after the education, so now we're into healthcare. And then after, it's criminal justice.
By yep. healthcare, they mean repeal Obamacare.
That's pretty much what it is, yeah. Dishonestly named the Affordable Care Act of 2010. Okay, yeah, well, we know that
it weighs like the dead hand of the past upon American medicine.
What? Where is that? That's in there?
That's the second sentence.
Oh, my God. There, yeah.
Scroll back up a little bit.
There. Okay, yeah, it's right there. Highlighted. It weighs like the dead hand of the past upon American medicine.
Neat.
It imposed a Euro-style bureaucracy to manage its unworkable, budget-busting, conflicting provisions.
And as we all know, those of us who've actually studied Euro-style health bureaucracies, it's not even freaking close.
No.
They're actually efficient.
Yeah. And they're also they're speaking for everyone here that that all insurance has gone up for everyone and that's not the case. You know, if that was the case, then more people would be still uninsured, but more people are insured now. Okay. We agree with the four dissenting. Yeah, so more activist judges or whatever, as they say. But yeah, generally they want to get rid of the Affordable Care Act.
In its place, we must combine what worked best in the past with changes needed for the future. We must recover the traditional patient-physician relationship based on mutual trust, informed consent, and confidentiality. To simplify the system for both patient and providers, we will reduce mandates and enable insurers and providers of care to increase healthcare options and contain costs. That's a key thing right there. Because enable insurers and providers of care to increase options and contain costs. Nothing about the patient.
No, it has nothing to do with the patient. Even though this is restoring patient control, that's the section, but there's no patient control involved in this. We will return to the states their historic role of regulating local insurance markets, limit federal requirements on both private insurance and Medicaid, and call on state officials to reconsider the costly medical mandates imposed under their own laws that price millions of low-income families out of the insurance market.
Essentially what will happen is the same thing that happened back in the day is almost all the insurance companies will move to a single state, which gives them the best options. And then just have satellite offices throughout the rest of the country.
Yeah. That's what has been traditionally done.
Those who don't learn from history.
Doomed to repeat it. Okay.
And those who do learn from history are doomed to watch everyone else repeat it.
Yeah, it's actually worse.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So let's just scroll up the totally down. Thing is,
to ensure vigorous competition in healthcare, and because cost awareness is the best guard against overutilization, we will promote price transparency so consumers can know the cost of treatments before they agree to them. AKA, are you sure you need that life-saving surgery or that surgery that might keep you from living in constant pain? Because this is how much it's going to cost you. You might not want to utilize it.
I wonder if that would actually allow you to then price shop, you know, take it to somewhere else, but I don't think so. I don't think
Well, even so, you can see what this is the price is going to be. Okay. Wow. And even if the lowest of the low is still $10,000.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm just going to start reading through here, just the headlines. Protecting individual conscience in healthcare. That's abortion coverage. So that's what they're talking about there.
They specifically mentioned parental consent.
Yep. Better care and lowering cost tort reform. We support state and federal legislation to cap non-economic damages in medical malpractice suit. So basically, we're going to say how much your life is actually worth.
Yeah.
We're going to let the state figure that one out.
Did this screw-up affect your ability to do your job? We don't care how much it hurts you, but did you lose an arm? Nope, doesn't matter then.
Yeah. Advancing research and development of healthcare. Let's see. Well, we talk about the scary ones, Ebola, Zika, chikungunya, and antibiotic-resistant pathogens. Continue our blah, blah, blah. Let's see. Oh, without the destruction of embryonic human life. Okay, that's nice. So we got to throw that in there, too.
We believe the FDA's approval of Mifeprex, a dangerous abortifacient formerly known as RU486, threatens women's health, as does the agency's endorsement of over-the-counter sales of powerful contraceptives without a physician's recommendation.
We support cutting federal and state funding for entities that endanger women's health by performing abortions in a manner inconsistent with federal or state law, which is none of them, if they're licensed. Also, they say that we urge a ban on human cloning for research or reproduction and a ban on the creation of or experimentation on human embryos for research. So even though they stated that this is advancing research and development in healthcare, we don't actually want to do that.
Nope.
At all. Putting patients first, reforming the FDA. The FDA needs leadership that can reform the agency from for our century and fix the lack of predictability, consistency, and transparency and efficacy in efficiency in the at the agency. Return to its traditional emphasis on hard science
and approving new breakthrough medicines.
Is it not there?
Yeah, it's like why is it's. It's not doing that? I thought that's part of their role. I guess they don't want it to do anything other than that. That's usually... That's usually
they don't
what that
want the first part. They just want the second part, approving new breakthrough medicines. Because the new breakthrough medicines are what make money.
Yeah, don't... Yeah, the FDA has slowly but relentlessly changed into an agency that more and more puts the public health at risk by delaying, chilling, and killing the development of new devices, drugs, and biologics that can promote our lives and our health.
They want to go back to the days of Bush W., George W. Bush.
Patent medicine is what they really want to go to.
He basically gutted the FDA for a number of years, to where The Onion published an article saying that the FDA is now just called the agency, because they don't regulate anything or do anything, they just seem to exist.
Yeah.
And it's been rebuilt over the course of this current administration.
Hey, look.
To actually perform its job.
The Republicans are pro-vaping. Rather than divert its attention to consume its resources, trying to over-regulate electronic health records or vaping.
Yep.
I love how that's just a random throw in there.
It's... Really? Vaping made it into your platform? Even if it's just
it's
a throwaway
because
line?
One of the, there was a senator, I believe.
Big Tobacco.
Or he might have, I think it was representative, was vaping on the House floor.
Was he?
Yeah. Guess which party?
Yeah, obviously. Okay. Moving along. Advancing Americans with Disabilities. Push all the wheelchairs right off a cliff. I think that's probably their idea. The Individuals with Disability Education Act idea has opened up unprecedented opportunities for many students. Okay, that's nice.
I love what they say. Persons with disabilities are nearly twice as likely to be self-employed as the general population.
So we want more people to be disabled.
They aren't going for the fact of that's usually because a disability they have or an issue they have means they are not hireable by a private corporation.
Yeah, they have to find their own way. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's other, you know, side reasons for all of these things. Fair Labor Standards Act to ensure... to encourage competitive employment for persons with disabilities. We affirm our support for its goal in minimizing the separation of children with disabilities from their peers. Okay, that sounds human.
Less lizard folk, more human, gotcha.
Less lizard folk. We oppose the non-consensual withholding of care of or treatment from people with disabilities, including... What? Non-consensual withholding of care We oppose euthanasia and assisted suicide.
There it is.
Which endanger especially those on the margins of society, like the people who are terminally ill.
Yeah, the terminally ill people on the edge. Yeah, yeah, that's who. We urge the DEA to restore its ban on the use of controlled substances for physician-assisted suicide. Okay, so that.
So when you are in that much pain, you're going to die anyways. You're not necessarily in that much pain, like that wonderful woman who was, I think, 23 or 24, but she was going to be dead in 6 months. There was nothing they could do about it.
And
she wanted to go out her way, not in a way of screaming in pain, because it was eating her alive.
It was terminal, yeah. It's like, there's no way out of this. Okay, so...
You know, the dignity of death, they are all about you will live no matter what. They are not about dying with dignity.
That's true. There's no death with dignity in the Republican Party. Okay, ensuring safe neighborhoods, criminal justice, and prison reform. Conduct the Department of Justice has... the conduct of the Department of Justice has included refusal to enforce laws, stonewalling congressional committees, destroying evidence, reckless dealing with firearms that led to several deaths on both sides of our border, and defying a citation for contempt. Okay. They say the current administration has a lack of respect for them. Interesting. Blue Lives Matter.
It gets beyond that. Two grave problems undermine the rule of law on the federal level: overcriminalization and overfederalization. In the first case, Congress and federal agencies have increased the number of criminal offenses in the U.S. Code from 3,000 in the early 1980s to more than 4,500 today. That does not include an estimated 300,000 regulations containing criminal penalties. No one, including the Department of Justice, can come up with accurate numbers. That recklessness is bad enough when committed by Congress, but when it comes from the unelected bureaucrats of the federal agencies, it is intolerable. So basically, all the things like, you know, hate crimes, those are, you know, over-criminalization. Because that's when they came about.
Wow. Wow.
Yep.
Okay.
To deal with this morass, we urge caution in the creation of new crimes and a bipartisan presidential commission to purge the code and the body of regulations of old crimes. We call for mens rea elements in the definition of any new crimes to protect Americans who, in violating a law, act unknowingly or without criminal intent.
So I didn't know it was against the law, man. I didn't know.
Except, again, the rule is...
ignorance of the law is no excuse.
Yep.
Which is why I'm also for a larger federal rule base, so that way I know what's against the law when I go to another state.
Yep.
We urge Congress to codify the common laws rule of leniency, which requires courts to interpret unclear statutes in favor of a defendant.
That is a very, very, very bad thing.
Could be. Could be bad. Okay. We applaud the Republican governors and legislators who have been implementing criminal justice reforms like those proposed by our 2012 platform, along with diversion of first-time nonviolent offenders to community sentencing, accountability courts, drug courts, veterans treatment courts, that's a lot of courts, and guidance by faith-based institutions with proven track records for rehabilitation, our platform emphasized restorative justice to make the victim whole and put the offender on the right path.
Now, remember, this is one of the things that comes about, and I've seen stories about this, where you get told by the, you know, you have to go to Alcoholics Anonymous or Narcotics Anonymous or any of those.
Yep.
Cool. One of the primary things you are required to do is acknowledge the authority of a divine being.
Yeah, they're all...
I have known and heard stories of atheists who have to go to these programs and then are thrown in jail because they refuse to acknowledge a divine being.
Yeah. And then they're denied the ability to go to take a secular program.
Yep.
Yep.
And the funny thing is, in now, truth,
there are many
of those programs at AA, well, some of them are good.
Yeah, they have a terrible recidivism rate.
A lot of them don't work.
They have a terrible recidivism rate. It's true.
Oh, yeah.
You know, statistically. It does work for some people. I know a few. But also, the good program runners will also, you know, put into it that, you know, you don't necessarily have to choose God. It can just be a power that is greater than yourself, whatever that happens to be. You know, if it's the cosmos, believe in the cosmos. You know, it doesn't make any difference. Just, you know, something outside of yourself. And but those are people that can run it good. Yeah, they know what they're doing.
But even though there's a lot of people out there who don't believe in any power greater than themselves.
Right.
Oh, but going on, they state in here that to be Republican means you're pro-death penalty. The constitutionality of the death penalty
is
firmly settled. Huh?
Okay.
Yeah, the constitutionality of the death penalty is firmly settled by its explicit mention in the Fifth Amendment. With the murder rate soaring in our great cities, we condemn the Supreme Court's erosion of the right of the people to enact capital punishment in their states. In solidarity with those who protect us, we call for mandatory prison time for all assaults involving serious injury to law enforcement officers.
Oh, wow.
I am one who will always say at this point, especially once after I've been educated about it, mandatory sentencing is a bad thing. It removes the ability of a judge to go, you know, in this case, we know what the defendant's intent was. Okay, it may have been a complete accident and an oops.
Wow.
But a mandatory sentence removes that ability of a judge to go to make a decision.
Oh, that's going to bog things down, too. We call on the Congress to make the federal courts a model for the rest of the country in protecting the rights of victims and their families. We should be told all relevant information about their case, allowed to be present for its trial, assured a voice in sentencing and parole hearings, given access to social and legal services, and benefit from the Crime Victims Fund established under President Reagan for that sole purpose. I can see it being good. I can also see it being really rough.
I can see it being good, but honestly, given the state of most federal and also local courts and the number and typically of how, how rape cases are handled.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's see if they would stand up for that.
I guess, we're definitely going to have to hit death penalty as a topic one day.
Yeah. Oh, they mention it in the platform at the very end paragraph. The internet must not become a safe haven for predators. Pornography, with its harmful effects, especially on children, has become a public health crisis that is destroying the lives of millions.
There it is.
We encourage states to continue to fight this public menace and pledge our commitment to children's safety and well-being. Remember, it's all about the kids.
Think of the
we
children.
We applaud the social networking sites that bar sex offenders from participation. We urge energetic prosecution of child pornography, which is closely linked to human trafficking. Now, that last bit is somewhat true.
Somewhat. Yeah. Okay. So
I think it's great because a lot of that shit happens in the Bible Belt states.
Oh, so I'm going to have to go back and make a new list of what it takes to be a Republican.
You have to hate pornography.
You got to hate pornography. You got to want to kill people in the death penalty. You got to, but at the same time, you also have to be anti-abortion. You're not exactly pro-life. You're pro-birth.
No, you want an abortion, that's fine. You then have to go before a jury and get the judge to say, that's okay.
Right.
Clearly that fetus is guilty of a future crime.
Yeah, we're going to sentence the fetus to death by electric chair. It might tingle a little bit. Oh, lordy, lordy, lordy. Okay. Okay, so combating drug abuse, basically I think they're going to continue the war on drugs that doesn't work.
Well, they talk about the marijuana, in many jurisdictions, marijuana is virtually legalized despite its illegality under federal law. Okay.
At the other end of the drug spectrum, heroin use nearly doubled from 2003 to 2013, while deaths from heroin have quadrupled.
You know what does? You know what brings that number down? Needle exchanges.
Does, yeah.
And a safe place for them to actually do those drugs, because if something happens to them, there's somebody right there to take care of them. And typically, as they've seen in some Canadian provinces where they have instituted these programs, a person who suddenly has an overdose and a near-death experience and is immediately taken care of tends to then look at the people and go, okay, I need to get off this stuff right now. What do I need to do?
Yeah. Yeah. And then don't make it hard for them to get the stuff that takes them off of it.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, it's a different opioid, but, you know, you still got to get off of it somehow. There's a method, and it works. So don't make it harder on people. Congress and a new administration should consider the long-range implications of these trends for public health and safety and prepare to deal with the problematic consequences.
Hmm.
Reefer Madness!
I've seen that movie, and it's hilarious.
It is. Then they talk about the misuse of prescription painkillers and opioids, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, but what gets me is down near the bottom of that, I had it a second ago. Republican legislation now allows Medicare Part D and Medicare Advantage plans to limit patients to a single pharmacy.
Huh. Good job, Republicans, on giving more choice to...
So if that pharmacy runs out of your medication and you need it, too bad. It'll be in tomorrow.
Yeah, you're hosed.
Or it'll be in next week.
Or
we're not going to take it. We're not going to support that stuff anymore. We're not going to carry it. Sorry. Or they might not carry the generic, so everything would have to be the name brand, super-duper expensive one.
Yep.
And then the Medicare Part D would then have to pay through the nose for it, in addition to whatever the patient would have to pay. We look for expeditious agreement between the House and Senate on the Comprehensive Addiction and Recovery Act, which addresses the opioid epidemic from both the demand and supply sides of the problem. That's nice. Okay, then we're into America Resurgent.
Yeah, we're finally on the end. We're finally in the home stretch.
We're in the home stretch. Oh, dear.
This
dear
is the lady. Last of the sections.
Yes, and then we'll all go home and go to sleep and
try
to dream
shiver
of,
and of realize this is what they're... It means to be Republican and move to Canada.
Yeah, so this is all bad. So we're now on what they call page 41. Yeah, it took us a while to go through all that. A lot of unpacking. Hey, they talk about Alexander Hamilton immediately.
Excellent. However, they more than likely have misconstrued or over conflating things.
Well, no doubt. So this is all propaganda on this page. So we have to skim. In all of our country's history, there is no parallel to what President Obama and his former Secretary of State have done to weaken our nation. That seems unfounded. I would like cited references, please.
Yeah, that requires some citing there.
Yeah, after nearly 8 years of Democratic Commander-in-Chief who has frequently placed strategic and ideological limitations and shackles on our military, our enemy... have been emboldened, and our national security is at great risk. Our country faces a national security crisis, and only by electing a Republican to the White House will restore law and order to our land and safety to our citizens.
Essentially, they're saying that's the only way baloney. We can be safe is to do what Reagan did, and anybody who looks crossways at us, we threaten to bomb them, and the first person who calls us on it, we blow the living crap out of them.
And then we
look at everybody else and go... What, you want some?
Yeah. Tyranny and injustice thrive when America is weakened. The oppressed have no greater ally than a confident and determined United States, backed by the strongest military on the planet. This is thug life, man. That's what this is. We're not only the police, but we're also the bullies of the world.
Whoa, hold on.
Fear
the next hammer. Sentence.
Quite simply, the Republican Party is committed to rebuilding the U.S. military into the strongest on the earth, with vast superiority over any other nation or group of nations in the world. We face a dangerous world, and we believe in a resurgent America.
To anyone out there who just heard that, we have the strongest military on earth, and we are vastly superior over every other nation or group of nations in the world.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, our military is bigger than the next 23 combined.
Yeah. We're no pushovers here.
Yeah, show us another government, a nation that can do what we can do militarily. There is none.
Yeah, they then go on to talk about different ways that apparently we have been weakened to try and justify their case. They're not doing a terribly good job, in my opinion, based on just the metrics that we already know. That's just a false statement. It's fear.
Wait, hold on.
Just fear mongering.
Also, our aging naval capabilities are inadequate for their job. One, they're not that aging. Two, ships can last for a long time. Three, yeah, they aren't inadequate at all.
Yeah, they're supposed to.
Sure, we don't have battleships anymore. I am one who would love to see battleships again because I just think they're cool, but we don't need them.
No.
The Air Force fields the smallest and oldest force of combat aircraft in its history. Mm. No, it fields the most effective it can.
Yeah.
It keeps trying to kill one of the most effective aircraft, and thankfully I've just had word recently that they have removed plans to kill the A-10.
Oh, good, good, good.
Yeah, they're like, they can't. It's just too damn good of a job, just let it do the whole thing. But that's also the, you know, spending $1.35 trillion on a plane that doesn't quite work is entirely okay because it's modernizing things.
Yeah.
Well, actually, the Marines and several other groups are actually going to using prop planes for ground attack.
Do you remember?
Wonderful.
Do you remember in the debates? This was the Biden versus Ryan debates.
Yes, yes.
When,
I think it was Biden versus Ryan.
Yeah, when he was, he actually said something about, you know, like muskets versus, you know, battleships.
Yeah,
there was.
Yeah,
some...
we no longer charge into battle with muskets and bayonets.
Yeah, we don't do that anymore. We have a very effective military, which means we don't need a military the size that it used to be. Sheer numbers don't mean dick.
Well, again, but they do the sheer numbers thing. The Marines have only 2/3 the number of battalions they have historically needed to meet day-to-day operational demands. That's because their day-to-day operational demands through most of their history has been active deployment in war.
Yeah, we don't really need as many. Again, it's need. We don't need that many.
Yeah, the individual trooper nowadays is more effective than they were back in World War II.
Way more effective. Yeah. Okay, so, and they got to mention Benghazi.
Oh, they do mention ballistic missile defenses.
Yeah, strategic missile defenses, strategic arms reduction treaty.
With Russia, defense installations in Poland and the Czech Republic have been neutralized, and the number of planned interceptors in Alaska has been reduced. Yes, because placing missiles and things like this in Turkey is what nearly caused World War III.
Yeah.
People forget that. The whole Cuban Missile Crisis was started because we placed a fairly small nuclear system in Turkey.
So what did they do?
They put
a small one in Cuba.
It's like, hey, we're going to keep equal to you, so come on, man.
Tit for tat, right there, yeah. So that doesn't make a whole lot of sense. They're just fear-mongering. Not understanding.
Apparently a weak administration has invited aggression.
Then confronting the dangers in the face of these threats. First order business for the Republican president and Congress will be to restore our nation's military might.
World War II levels.
To World War II levels.
Semi-automatic weapons.
Yeah, to World War II levels. We aren't at war like that.
Let's bring back the M1 Garand. Let's go.
We just don't need it like this.
We must rebuild troop numbers and readiness and confirm their mission, protecting the nation, not nation building.
But We're fine over here. We're essentially an island nation.
But beyond that, what did Bush do? And he specifically used the term nation building?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Supporting our troops, resources to do their job. Again, of course, you know, this is where all that government spending that they don't want to pay is all going right here.
Yeah.
This is the only government that they support being huge. And their own salaries, which they vote for regularly to go up. I'm disgusted by this. I'm just going to move right along. Supporting our troops, standing by our heroes, which they don't do. We've gone on with that in different sections. This section might as well not even be here.
I think you skipped some, but that's fine.
I did. I skipped the supporting our troops' resources to do on the job. I skipped that whole section.
No, I just love the fact that they mention, back in the Confronting the Dangers, we will no longer tolerate a president whose rules of engagement put our own troops in harm's way or commanders who tell their soldiers that their first duty is to fight climate change.
Wow, they just had to toss that in there, didn't they?
Had to toss it in there. I just had to mention that.
Yeah, there it is. Wow. Okay. Special operations forces are simply not intended to deal with the full spectrum of threats. That's nice. Okay.
Where is that? Because I want to read the rest of that, because I think I might call bullshit on that.
Right here.
No, we need a Reagan-era force. They can fight and win 2.5 wars ranging from counterterrorism to deterring major power aggressors. There is a quote, and it is partially an actual quote, and then I will quote the one actually from Babylon 5.
Okay.
The quote is, "Only an idiot fights a war on two fronts. Only the heir to the throne of the kingdom of idiots fights a war on 12 fronts." Every military commander will tell you straight up, never fight a war on two fronts if you can help it.
That's what took down Germany in World War II.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what really took them down. We should abandon arms control treaties? Oh, wow. Okay.
Wow. Okay. Yeah, that's that benefit our adversaries. Well, okay, technically any arms control treaty will quote-unquote, benefit our adversaries.
It's a mutual thing. That's
because, you know, the fastest way we could have dealt with everything in Afghanistan or Iraq, just nuke the whole place.
Yeah.
But we don't do that.
Nukes are very effective that way. Very effective. Oh, man. Okay.
I will say, the Standing By Our Heroes section,
yeah,
they do actually mention suicides.
Oh, do they? Okay.
Second column, first full paragraph.
The burden of our countries? Okay.
Yeah.
Burden of our countries. Extended military involvement in the Middle East has taken a toll on our service personnel. Suicides among our military, active duty troops, reservists, National Guardsmen, and veterans are at shocking levels. While post-service medical conditions, including addiction and mental illness, require more and more assistance. More than ever, our government must work with the private sector to advance opportunities and provide assistance to those wounded in spirit as well as in body, whether through experimental efforts like the PAWS, Puppies Assisting Wounded Servicemen, program for service dogs, or through the faith-based institutions that have traditionally been providers of counseling and aid.
So your two choices are experimental or faith-based. There's nothing else.
That's
no, I'm all for PAWS. Let's be honest here.
PAWS is cool.
I've seen programs like that. I'm all for that, and they actually do work really well.
Yeah. We support the right of conscience of military chaplains and all their faith practices to practice their faith free from political influence.
AKA, I'm a chaplain. I'm supposed to represent everybody. But I'm actually a Christian, so no, I'm not going to do that for you, which I have seen actually happen.
Yeah, that's exactly what happens. And that is stated right here. We reject attempts by the Obama administration to censure and silence them, particularly Christians and Christian chaplains. Not particularly, only.
Yeah.
Only.
Because a chaplain is supposed to
service.
Yes, they might
all
have
of
a specific background
needs.
Themselves, but they are supposed to help
yeah.
every faith member, regardless yeah. of whether their faith shares their own or not.
A Muslim serviceman should be able to go to a Christian chaplain and still have their spiritual needs addressed. That's their job.
Yeah.
Of
course, the funny thing is, most people won't realize that chaplains, I don't know if they now, but I remember back in the day, chaplains were not allowed to carry firearms.
I don't know if that's true anymore. I don't know if that's true anymore.
They had an armed bodyguard, but they themselves were not allowed to carry a firearm. That may have changed, but I know like 5-8 years ago, that was the way it was.
A Republican commander-in-chief will also encourage education regarding the religious liberties of military personnel under both the First Amendment and the U.S. Constitution and the current National Defense Authorization Act. That's right. You can be any religion.
A Republican commander-in-chief will protect the religious freedom of all military members, especially chaplains, and will not tolerate attempts to ban Bibles or religious symbols from military facilities.
That's separation of church and state right there.
That beyond separate church and state, that's also, I've known, again, I read a lot of military stories, especially when it comes to religion. I've read stories of people who, they are harassed, they are assaulted, they are just given the nth degree, they are skipped over for promotion opportunities because they're not Christian, and they keep getting harassed by their immediate commanders, immediate superiors. They report it, and they are either laughed at by the people above them, or they are ignored. Or they are told by the people above them that, no, sorry, you have to deal with this with your commander, who's the one who's giving you all this problem.
Yeah. It can get really ugly out there for people that are not the traditional norm.
They support an all-volunteer force and oppose unnecessary policy changes, including compulsory national service and selective service registration of women for a possible future draft.
So they don't want women in the Selective Service. We don't want to draft no women.
They reiterate their support for both the advancement of women in the military and their exemption from direct ground combat and infantry battalions. So you can be in the motor pool.
Yeah, but we don't.
You ain't going to shoot things.
We don't want you to be able to do everything in the military.
Yeah.
Sorry, it's already done. But, yeah. We affirm the cultural values that encourage selfless service and superiority in battle. We oppose anything which might divide or weaken team cohesion, including intramilitary special interest demonstrations. In particular, we warn against modification or lessening of standards in order to satisfy a non-military agenda imposed by the White House. We're not lessening standards. We're just allowing women to even try.
Yeah.
The standards are the same. Nothing's changed. But they're assuming that that's what's going to happen. We call for an objective review on the impact and readiness of the current administration's ideology-based personnel policies. That's not even a name that's going on there, yeah. America has a sacred trust with our veterans, and we are committed to ensuring them and their families care and dignity. Then pass a damn veterans' health care bill.
No. They have a sacred trust with veterans and are committed to ensuring them and their families' care and dignity as long as they are an active part of the military.
Right. As soon as you're out of the military, good luck.
As soon as you are truly a veteran,
yeah.
Good luck. Why should we support you? You're not helping us anymore. We don't care what you did. We supported you during those times. Yeah.
Military readiness should not be sacrificed on the altar of political correctness.
Once again, it's like the war on poverty.
Yeah.
However.
Okay, so then we get into citizen soldiers, National Guards, and reserves.
Beyond that, it's the next sentence. We oppose legislative attempts to modify the system of military justice that would undermine its fairness and due process rights for all concerned, both the accuser and the accused. AKA, given how military justice currently works, all those sexual assaults, we don't want them to be made on the radar. We want this all to just be blown away. We want this all to be acquitted. Let it go.
Don't bring a black eye to the service, kind of thing.
Yeah, because being sexual assault in the military is a very, very common thing and is almost never settled in the accuser's favor.
Yeah, it's really rare. Really rare. For it to even come up in the first
place. And even if it is, your military career pretty much at that point is over, especially considering most times you were assaulted, it will be by a superior officer.
Yeah. Not pretty. Not pretty, folks. Okay, so into the National Guard and Reserve. Welcome back, David. And also,
I have to excuse myself, gentlemen.
That's right. It is time for you to turn into a pumpkin. Thank you very much for joining us this evening, and I'm sorry that this has taken so much of our life away.
Yeah, well, horrible things tend to do that.
Yeah, but this is fascinating, and we're arming ourselves for the future, and more importantly, we will now have something to compare the DNC platform against.
Yeah. We've there just sucked 3 hours of your life away. How does that make you feel?
Sad, actually.
Fascinating. Yes. I'll never get it back.
No. But hopefully we'll have at least some good talking points, and we'll know our adversary.
Yeah, I'm just going to buy more guns and be ready for them.
That, sadly, might be the best way to go. Okay, there's...
Peace.
Later.
See you later, man. There's so much left in this stupid document. Obviously, the last pages we're not really going to look at. There's apparently, you know, on the very last page, confronting internet tyranny.
Protection against an electromagnetic pulse.
Yeah.
I'm impressed because, honestly, at this point, there is none with most of our infrastructure.
An EMP is no longer a theoretical concern.
That's true, because the amount of people who have nuclear weapons.
No. It is no longer a theoretical concern. It is a real threat. That's what they state. Nonetheless, hundreds of electrical... Okay, blah, blah, blah. Let me see. So that was the last page. Kind of working
liberty
backwards.
To captive. We're going reverse now. Face the 21st century threats. Yeah. Cybersecurity in an insecure world.
Okay, I don't think they know how the
we must
works.
Stop playing defense and go on offense to avoid the cyber equivalent of Pearl Harbor.
Wow.
That's impressive.
Oh, geez.
Combating human trafficking.
Yeah, an estimated 21 million people worldwide are trapped in modern-day slavery. Full force of law. Trafficking victims. No, nobody wants... human trafficking, that should be in both parties. It's like, how are you different?
That should be a simple thing. There we go.
Yeah, the goal of our domestic anti-trafficking program should be the rescue and safe return of victims to their homes, not creating a long-term dependency upon public support. We're going to get you, and then we're going to kick you.
Yeah.
That's pleasant. Okay. Moving, again, advancing human rights,
also, a lot of what I'm seeing there is all about help dealing with foreign things, not dealing with the human trafficking that occurs directly inside this country. Mostly, wow. We're dealing with foreign contractors and foreign labor groups who might have them helping work on military bases.
Yeah.
Not dealing with the millions of people who are actually here.
The United States, this is on page 53, the United States needs a radical rethinking of our human rights diplomacy. A Republican administration will adopt a whole-of-government approach to protect fundamental freedoms globally, one where pressing human rights and rule of law issues are integrated at every appropriate level of our bilateral... Jeez, that's so thick!
Okay, let's see if I can do it. All right, testing. A Republican administration will adopt a whole-of-government approach to protect fundamental freedoms globally, one where pressing human rights and rule-of-law issues are integrated at every appropriate level of our bilateral relationships and strategic decision-making. Republican policy will reflect the fact that the health of the U.S. economy and environment, the safety of our food and drug supplies, the security of our investments and personal information in cyberspace, and the stability and security of the oceans will increasingly depend on allowing the free flow of news and information and developing an independent judiciary and civil society in countries with repressive governments such as China, Russia, and many nations of the Middle East and Africa. I'm going to throw in here Saudi Arabia.
None of that says anything.
Basically, no. It says we need a radical rethink human rights, and we want to have all these things applied to, and we want to enforce it, and have all these things applied to all of the people everywhere. But I'm going, okay, then do it. And do not sacrifice, I said, do not sacrifice human rights and human dignity upon the altar of political expediency and the altar of having allies in other countries. Be willing to look at Saudi Arabia and tell them to piss off.
Sadly, there is something here that that I have to agree with them. A Republican administration, though I don't think they can do this, a Republican administration will never say, as Hillary Clinton did as Secretary of State in 2009, that raising human rights concerns can't interfere with the global economic crisis, the global climate change crisis, and the security crisis.
I'm trying to read, understand how what's being said there.
Basically, they're presuming that she is putting human rights at least as fourth in that list.
Whereas I'd say they're all pretty much number one in different categories.
Right, but they're claiming that human rights should always, always be there, right at the top. Which, you know, being a human, I am in favor of human rights. Last I checked, my zipper is intact. I'm still a human. So, I'm good on that.
I do like the fact that they go with the thing that everyone thinks of when it comes to any form of human trafficking and such, and that is women trafficked into sexual slavery. They don't talk about what is the actual vast majority of slavery and human trafficking in the world, especially the United States, has absolutely nothing to do with sexual slavery. 68% of all people who are enslaved and are victims of human trafficking in the United States are doing forced labor.
Oh,
only 22% are in sexual slavery of some kind.
Yeah. Basically, our prison population ends up being our modern-day slave labor.
In a way, but the actual human trafficking victims, most of them are doing standard sweatshop labor.
Yeah.
Or the people who can't speak English who come to your work or the hotels and clean.
Okay. Still moving backwards now.
Moving in reverse order.
Yeah, so that was into advancing human rights. Now, let's see. America's generosity, international assistance that makes a difference.
Okay, I see peace through strength. Once again, quoting Reagan.
I will just go back to advancing human rights real quick, because they say, oh, look, radical Islamic terrorism. One of their key talking points is right there. So that's always good. Let's see. Advance of political freedom and entrepreneurial capitalism drives economic growth, catalyzes private sector development, and is the only sustainable solution to poverty. Really? Okay.
Yeah.
Over the last 50 years, the level of private investment overseas from the United States has eclipsed aid many times over. Our development strategy must build on recent Republican efforts to use foreign assistance to catalyze private sector investments and expertise in addressing global challenges that can build a more stable world and advance America's national security and economic interests. I think they're paid by the word.
Also, I'm just looking at this going, why? At this point, why doesn't this guy just throw down the paperwork and just declare themselves Ares Corporation?
Because they never played Shadowrun. Yeah.
Because they're all the stuff we're reading is going, okay, they are literally campaigning to be a megacorp.
Yeah. But without...
Ooh.
Yeah.
The previous column, defending international religious freedom.
What? Where is that?
Still going up the page as we're going in reverse order?
Yeah.
Before America's generosity.
Ah, okay. Moving on up. Okay. Okay, so a Republican administration will return the advocacy of religious liberty to a central place in its diplomacy. We'll quickly designate the systematic killing of religious and ethnic minorities a genocide, and we'll work with the leaders of other nations to condemn and combat genocidal acts. So,
going earlier, religious minorities across the Middle East have been driven from their ancient homelands. They're talking about the Yazidis there, which are Christian, and thousands there and in Africa have been slaughtered for their faith in what the State Department has belatedly labeled genocide. The United States must stand with leaders like President Sisi of Egypt, who has bravely protected the rights of Coptic Christians in Egypt, and call on other leaders across the region to ensure that all religious minorities, whether Yazidi, Baha'i, Orthodox, Catholic, or Protestant Christians, are free to practice their religion without fear of persecution. At a time when China has renewed its destruction of churches, Christian homeschooling parents are jailed in parts of Europe, and even Canada threatens pastors for their preaching, the Republican administration will return the advocacy of religious liberty to a central place in its diplomacy.
Wow. What section was that? Oh, defending international religious freedom. That was just that is the section. Okay. I really thought we had a secular government. Really thought that.
Are we going to have a military coup a la Turkey because of our government getting too religious?
I didn't say that.
I'm not actually saying that either.
I did not say that at all, Mr. NSA agent. I didn't say that at all. Those words never crossed my lips. This is merely a forum of discussion. We are speaking academically of such things.
Again, I just want to know so I can get out of the firing lines.
Okay. Sovereign American leadership in international organizations. Oh, this is about our continued participation in the UN. Should be contingent on the enactment of a long overdue changes in the way that institution functions.
AKA, it better be an American puppet or we're not going to deal with it anymore. We want to maintain our absolute control.
American taxpayers, the chief funders of the UN, deserve full transparency in the financial operations of its overpaid bureaucrats. It does not like the Human Rights Council.
Of course not.
Its Human Rights Council, composed of some of the world's worst tyrants, that's actually a good point, and its treatment of Israel as a pariah state, the UN's population fund has, from its origin, been rooted in no-growth policies that limit economic development in the countries needing it most. Interesting.
However, their next thing is actually false.
Pardon me, I had to toss a cat.
It's a great talking point, but it's also, as we know for anyone who's actually studied it, false. Its complicity in China's barbaric program of forced abortion. China has never had a policy of forced abortion.
By having them have a one child per family, or two child per family.
One child.
Now that's gone, but by having that at all, remember, in the minds of these folks, any contraception is abortion, essentially.
Yeah, but is the idea they had it was a very big thing, a very anti-China thing that was done for a while. They said, one child policy, stories coming out about forced abortion and everything else. No, China basically said, and this only applied in the cities. In rural areas, it did not apply. In the cities, yes, it was a one child policy, and if you had more than one child, you paid a tax. That was it.
Oh. Well, there you go then.
That's how it actually worked.
Okay, so let's move over to Africa, the promise and the challenge. So I think that, yep, there's Boko Haram, of course, Al-Shabaab, and others like them. Radical Islam. Radical Islam! Your terror falls on both Muslims and Christians, of course. We recognize Africa's extraordinary potential. It's huge, and we don't have enough oil wells in it.
Essentially. I love the fact they actually mention about AIDS relief and the global fight to fight AIDS, tuberculosis, malaria, and what George W. Bush tried to do under these things. I'm going, yeah, but the most effective actual programs for AIDS in Africa were the ones that taught and had condom use and access.
Yep.
And then other ones came in and told everybody that they don't work and they're bad and
they
all other
cause
kinds
it.
Of things. So they stopped using it and AIDS went back up.
Yep. Yep.
And let's not forget the Kill the Gays bill.
Yeah, we can. Okay, moving on. Let's see.
Moving on up.
They're bad enough. Family of the Americas.
So Canada and South America, Central America and us.
Okay, yeah. So our future is intimately tied to the future of the Americas. Family, language, culture, environment, and trade link us closely to both Canada and Mexico. Our relations with both of these friends will be based upon continuing cooperation and walls. No, and our mutually shared interests. Walls. our attention to trade and environmental issues will contribute to strong economic growth and prosperity throughout the Americas. Okay. We thank our neighbors, Mexico and Canada, who have been partners in fighting against terrorism and the war on drugs.
Remember, drugs are winning.
Yep. The Mexican people deserve our assistance as they bravely resist the drug cartels that traffic in death on both sides of the border.
True.
Yep. Our Canadian neighbors can count on our cooperation and respect to advance North America's energy independence. There's the Keystone XL pipeline.
Yep.
We'll let that run right on through us. No problem.
We intend to reverse the current administration's blocking of the Keystone XL pipeline, but what about the native people who don't want it?
Well, remember, some of their earlier policies was about the, you know, America.
You're not properly using your land, so we're going to help you use your land and pay you for it. Yeah.
That's right. That's already in there. That's included in the platform.
True.
Yeah, they hit that already. It's sad that I'm putting these things together at this point. Okay, so we express our solidarity with all the peoples of the Western Hemisphere. Their aspirations for economic betterment and political liberty have deserved better from our government than its policies of the last 8 years.
Hold on, it gets better. The current administration has abandoned America's friends and rewarded its enemies. Whatever. A Republican president will never embrace a Marxist dictator in Venezuela or anywhere else. Do I really need to go with Bush's policies in Venezuela? Really?
I don't think we have the time.
That's a different show. We'll get to that later.
Yep. The current chief executive has allowed the country to become a narco-terrorist state, an Iranian outpost threatening Central America, and a safe haven for the agents of Hezbollah. Okay.
Wait, no, I love this. Now, with their country ruined by socialism and on the verge of chaos, let me bring this up really quickly here because I have heard this argument before that socialism doesn't work because look at Venezuela. Venezuela suffers from what is known as the resource curse. What that is your entire economy is based on a single resource. The Venezuelan economy is like 80 or 90% based on oil. So when that price goes up, like it had for a while, they're rocking, they're good, everything's amazing. Then when the price of oil collapses, their entire economy goes with it. Our economy, and most of Europe's economy,
is diversified.
Which most of Europe, as you know, is socialist, is not beholden to the resource curse, because they are not beholden to natural resources. Know this, learn this, spread this out to your friends, and get it out there, because I'm tired of hearing it.
Yeah.
In college education, liberal. Yeah.
Yeah. We affirm our friendship and admiration with the people of Colombia and call on Republican Congress to express its solidarity with their decades-long fight against the terrorist FARC. Their sacrifices and suffering must not be betrayed by our accession to power of murderers and drug lords. Okay. And we want to welcome the people of Cuba back into our hemispheric family after their corrupt rulers are forced from power and brought to account for their crimes against humanity. Not yet, only after they're gone. As long as there's a Castro involved, we don't want anything to do with Cuba. That's what they're saying. We stand with the women in white and all the victims of the loathsome regime that clings to power in Havana. We do not say this lightly. They have been betrayed by those who currently control the U.S. foreign policy. The current administration's opening to Cuba was shameful accommodation to the demands of its tyrants.
What this is open and blatant pandering to the Cubans in Florida. And I've been, I'll say this again, I've been on a cruise ship across the Caribbean with, on a quinceañera with my Cuban friend who eventually became my ex-fiance.
Yeah.
Who, I was on there when we drove past Cuba. You could see it on the horizon, partially lit up at the middle of the night. And I was there with like 300 or 400 drunk Cubans, and I have never heard more angry Spanish screaming in my life.
Huh.
Because most of them were first generation. They came from Cuba there to the United States.
Okay, so this is regime change. We want to install our own form of government there, and then we'll talk.
But we're not for nation building.
We're obviously for nation building because they just said it right here.
Yeah.
Yeah. As in, we call it, for those of you that don't believe me and are not listening, we call on the Congress to uphold current U.S. law, which sets conditions for the lifting of sanctions on the island, legalization of political parties and independent media, and free and fair internationally supervised elections. Yeah, I'm all for that, but that's not our business. That shouldn't be our business. We have relations with other tyrannies all across the world.
Yeah.
You know, they're our nearest neighbor.
We call for a dedicated platform for the transmission of radio and TV Marti and for the promotion of internet access and circumvention technology as tools to strengthen Cuba's pro-democracy movement.
Let's circumvent their entire government. Let's give them internet access. Man. Okay. So that was the Americas. Let's see. Okay, renewing the European alliance. Wait, what's before the European alliance here? U.S. leadership in the Asian Pacific. Okay, yeah, we'll talk about.
Talk about that in a minute, because
renewing the European alliance with bipartisan support. President Truman forged the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. Otherwise known as NATO, as an alliance of the Western democracies. It continues effectiveness is vital, especially in light of recent military challenges in Eastern Europe. Okay. What are they going to screw up now? Our historic ties to the people of Europe have been based on shared culture and values. We recognize with regret the increasing trend among many of our allies to move away from rights and liberties that Americans hold dear, especially freedom of speech.
Basically, how dare you do what we don't like, even though we fought and died to help defend you and, well, pretty much the whole world 60, 80 years ago. Beyond that, going back to the first paragraph, they actually mention, with the American people spending on defense per capita 4 times the amount spent by Europeans, we demand, as we have in the past, that our fellow members of NATO fulfill their commitments and meet their need for greater investment in their armed forces. AKA, we're tired of having our own military bases there. Start doing it your damn self.
Something like that, but not that we're ever going to pull the military base out. They just want other people to spend more as well so that we have even more to draw upon.
Yep.
That's part of building up the larger force. We honor our special relationship with the people of the United Kingdom and are grateful for their staunch support in the fight against terrorism. We respect their decision concerning the nation's relationship to the European Union and pledge that however much our international relationships may change, those who were first on our side in our hour of loss will always rank first in our policies and our esteem. Okay.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah, we'll make new deals with you. It's fine if you don't want to be part of the European Union. You're still on our side, buddy. No problem. It's okay.
Again, it's the young kid wheeling the aged old grandmother, her original mother, across the street. We remember, Mom.
It's okay.
Good old days, yeah, we remember.
It's okay. I understand what you were trying to do. It's okay. Yeah. Let's see. So, contribute effort to Iraq, Afghanistan, elsewhere, support sacrifice, blah, 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 for our...
Yeah, for the people of Russia. We affirm our respect and our determination to maintain a friendship beyond the reach of those who wish to divide us. We have common imperatives: ending terrorism, combating nuclear proliferation, promoting trade, and more. We also have a common problem: the continuing erosion of personal liberty and fundamental rights under the current officials in the Kremlin. How are they affecting us? Repressive at home and reckless abroad, their policies imperil the nations which regained their self-determination upon the collapse of the Soviet Union. We will meet the return of Russian belligerence with the same resolve that led to the collapse of the Soviet Union. We will not accept any territorial change in Eastern Europe imposed by force in Ukraine, Georgia, or elsewhere, and will use all appropriate constitutional measures to bring justice to the practitioners of aggression and assassination. Except we've already accepted territorial change in Ukraine.
Yep. We urge greater attention in U.S. diplomacy, trade, and strategic planning to the nations of Eurasia, formerly parts of the Soviet Empire. Let's see. Those developments will not only improve the living conditions throughout the vast area, but likely to reduce the lure of the radical ideologies that already threaten the region. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So more anti-Muslim stuff. Islam bad, Islam bad, Islam bad. Okay, so...
Now the Asian Pacific.
Yeah, let me see. Where exactly are we? We're getting warm here. Not that warm.
Warmer.
Oh, this is interesting, though. Scrolling back.
Also, go back up. Okay.
Yeah, we'll meet in the middle somewhere. But America, the indispensable nation, page 46. For the last several generations, our country's two major political parties were dedicated to the nation's security and the advance of freedom around the world. Okay. Bipartisan commitment has tragically changed. Leadership of the Democratic Party, both those in office and those who seek it, no longer see America as a force for good in the world. Really? I don't think that was ever stated, ever. Ever?
No, beyond that. It's not that they don't see America as a force for good in the world. It's that they're unwilling to say, hey, we're a force for good in the world. Look at this gun in my hand and I'll shoot you if you don't agree with me.
Yeah, they think they cannot be trusted to advance either the cause of liberty or our national security in the dangerous years in which we live. I don't think they're that much more dangerous than they have been previously.
We're not Germany. We're not France. Yeah. We don't suffer terrorist attacks on that. We don't really suffer terrorist attacks like that.
No.
So we're not actually under that much threat.
No. Many other nations in the world, and I hate to say this to people because they're not gonna, they're just gonna freak out. Many other nations in the world fear us as being the one that's going to come in and be tyrannical.
There's a quote I need to find here because it is so true. Dealing with a lot of these people.
Okay, we affirm our party's tradition of world leadership established by President Eisenhower and followed by every Republican president since. It stands for enormous power and the prudence to use it sparingly, precisely, and only in grave necessity. It stands for involvement, not intervention. It requires consultation, not permission. Requires consultation, not permission to act. leads from the front and ensures all others do their parts as well. It embraces American exceptionalism and rejects the false prophets of decline and diminution. It is, in sum, the way we will lead the world into a new century of greater peace and prosperity. Another American century. Really?
Yeah.
Really? That's... Man. Okay. Then challenges of a changing Middle East. Middle East is more dangerous now than ever. We consider the administration's deal with Iran to lift international sanctions and make hundreds of billions of dollars available to the mullah, a personal agreement between the president and his negotiating partners, and non-binding to the next on the next president.
I found sort of the quote,
okay,
which reminds me a lot about what the Republicans go about this whole military thing, military thing, military thing. It's from Tremors 2.
Oh.
Where, yeah, Bert, who's this massive gun nut,
yeah,
love the character.
Yeah.
He arrives at the place, he tells his wife has left him, and says the reason the wife left him is because she sees that apparently he can't live and handle life without the threat of nuclear annihilation because the Soviet Union fell.
Wow.
And I'm seeing a lot of that reference in what I'm seeing here, and the fact that we have to have this ultimate military, this ultimate power, look at what we have to have, look at this threat over here, they can't conceive or live in a world where there is not an existential threat which could at any moment completely annihilate us.
A giant thing has to be fought at all times.
Yeah.
It's the only thing that makes sense in this world.
Yeah.
Huh.
It's frightening, the fact that it sounds true and seems to fit the facts.
Oh, wow. Okay. Without a two-thirds endorsement by Senate, it does not have treaty status. So they a Republican president will immediately, you know, clamp sanctions back down on Iran.
Or he'll get in, and then they'll immediately go ahead and ratify it. And then say, look at what he did, look at all the good things he did.
It'll be under him, yeah. Yeah, there'll be some, you know, some pomp and circumstance around it. Yeah, you're probably right. Yeah. Though because of it, and the defiant and emboldened regime in Tehran continues to sponsor terrorism across the region, develop a nuclear weapons test fire ballistic missile inscribed with "Death to Israel," and abuse the basic human rights of its citizens. That seems wrong. On the face of it.
Again, a lot of it is, do they sponsor terrorism? Yes, they do. It's known. Because they sponsor organizations that they don't see as terrorist organizations, but a lot of other countries see as terrorist organizations. That's entirely true.
Yeah.
Test fire ballistic missiles inscribed with "Death to Israel." Yeah. Part of that is, anyone who's familiar with the idea of, oh, look, here we are, we're the government, we have some problems. We're going to show that we're still strong and everything else by having this little bit of saber rattling so the public can get behind us. That's more what that is.
Hmm.
And don't worry about your problems over here. Look how cool this is.
They're blaming the Obama administration and the Secretary of State for mishandling the Arab Spring and destabilizing the entire region.
Yeah, that actually hurts me to try to even consider how they're viewing that, because no.
Yeah, they didn't do anything except speak.
Yeah, because, okay, what should we have done? Marched militaries in there and supported people?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, because that's called... invasion.
And nation building.
And also, that would have immediately turned those people against us. All of them. Because we are a foreigner intervening in domestic affairs.
The dictator of Syria, Bashar Assad, has murdered hundreds of thousands of his own people and created millions of refugees, and an American president has been unable to rally the world against him. So basically, they would have preferred us to kill Assad, I think. Just pop him.
Yeah, that's, you want to talk about this destabilization. Assad's done some bad things. Yes, Assad has used chemical weapons. Yes, I'm one of those people who goes, when you draw a line and then someone steps across it, you need to then do something. Either don't draw the line in the first place.
Yeah.
Or do what you said you would do. And honestly, as soon as we've confirmed chemical weapons, we honestly, militarily, should have gone and deposed him. That's my view gone. No, you've done this. You've used a weapon of mass destruction. Mm-hmm. No. We're done pulling you out. We'll let the Syrians figure out who the hell they want, but you're done.
Yeah. We must stand up for our friends, challenge our foes, and destroy ISIS.
ISIS is pretty good being destroyed right now. I mean, let's be honest here.
Yeah.
The Iraqi military, the Kurdish military, all those people, they're actually doing a pretty damn good job. Oh, yeah. And it's Muslim forces that are doing it. Let's not forget that.
It's good. Well, that's why it's not getting any news. The Iraqi people have been on the front lines in the fight against terror. Hundreds of thousands have been killed in the attack. Attacks against them continue even in Baghdad. Our partnership...
Most of that, hundreds of thousands have been by us, so let's be honest here.
Yeah. Our partnership with them should continue as long as ISIS and others like it survive in the region. So forever. We are deeply concerned that in the face of genocide against them, Christian communities in cities like Erbil are receiving no financial support from either U.S. government or the U.N. to help with displaced persons and urban refugees. But we don't want to do anything with the refugees, do we?
But beyond that, I know their view is, it's the issue we have with it comes to, it's the opposite view of the welfare state. The idea, we just throw money at the problem.
Yeah.
Here they're saying, just throw money at the problem.
You're right.
We do throw money at the problem. The problem is the money isn't going where we want it to go. We're handing it over to the Iraqi government, and then they're doing with it what they will.
Yeah. We continue to support the Kurdish people. Okay, what are you going to do differently? I'm looking for differences. I'm not seeing a whole lot of differences, really, in many things. Other than many of their actions are probably going to just continue to destabilize the region.
Yeah.
You know, that they're overlooking the intricacies of the Iran deal. There's a lot going on with that. Yeah. Okay, our unequivocal support for Israel. We reaffirm America's commitment to Israel's security and we'll ensure that Israel maintains a qualitative military edge over any and all adversaries.
I want a thought experiment here. I want to know if Israel just decided to say, screw it, and went in and invaded and wiped out everyone who was not an Israeli in the Western Bank and or rounded them up and put them in camps, how would the Republicans react?
They'd lose their minds. We reject the false notion that Israel is an occupier and specifically recognize that the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions Movement, BDS, is anti-Semitic in nature and seeks to destroy Israel. Therefore, we call for effective legislation to thwart actions that intend to limit commercial relations with Israel or persons or entities doing business with Israel, in Israel, or in Israel-controlled territories in a discriminatory manner.
But you have a problem with people doing commercial business and commercial relations in Palestinian territories.
Well, that's because they're not justified. Yeah. So we can't support them. Or something like that. Yeah. So they're just going to continue to establish more and more footholds into Israel. Our party is proud to stand with Israel now and always. Okay.
Well, beyond that, the United States seeks to assist in the establishment of a comprehensive and lasting peace in the Middle East to be negotiated among those living in the region. That's like, okay, cool. We know, but lots of us, and I've talked to some people from that region, know the best way to do that. However, we oppose any measures intended to impose an agreement or to dictate borders or other terms. We call for the immediate termination of all U.S. funding to any entity that attempts to do so. Most people in the area have said a multi-state solution is how you fix the problem.
It's pretty much the only way.
You just wipe the borders, redraw them. There we go. Draw them along tribal lines. Do it done. Click. Problem solved.
Yeah. Oh boy, yeah. Well, we've talked on the show about Israel and why it is there. Obviously, we need to revisit it because that was the history of how it began, and there's more to unpack. Always more to unpack. Okay, so I think this is the last section.
Yep. U.S. leadership in the Asian Pacific.
The light at the end of the tunnel. Okay. We are a Pacific nation with economic, military, and cultural ties to all the countries of the Oceanic Rim and treaty alliances with Japan, South Korea, Australia, the Philippines, and Thailand. With them, we look toward the establishment of human rights for the people of North Korea. We urge the government of China to recognize the inevitability of change in the Kim family's slave state, and for everyone's safety against nuclear disaster to hasten positive change in the Korean Peninsula. The United States will continue to demand the complete, verifiable, and irreversible dismantlement of North Korea's nuclear weapons program with full accounting of its proliferation activities. We also pledge to counter any threats from the North Korean regime.
The greatest thing about that is we don't have to. Because China will.
Yeah.
People forget this, and I've talked to some interesting people and everything else, and publicly the Chinese officials will not say anything. Privately, Chinese officials will say or allude to a lot. One of the primary things is basically, if North Korea really steps out of line, aka they decide to truly cross the border and try an invasion of South Korea, or try to actually deploy a nuclear weapon, North Korea will cease to exist. Yeah, they'll become a subsidiary state of China for the most part, but
yeah,
we won't have to worry about them anymore.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's North Korea. On to Taiwan, and then we talk about China, and I'm not seeing anything new there. This is mostly just State Department stuff that isn't actually going to be different than what we already are doing. Mm-hmm. It's just a call out to them. Like, hey, we know foreign policy and stuff. It's just continue to do this.
Saying, look, this is foreign policy.
Yeah.
We can do that foreign policy thing.
Taiwan has merited our strong support, including free trade agreement status, the timely sale of defensive arms, including technology to build diesel submarines, and full participation in the World Health Organization, International Civil Aviation Organization, and other multilateral institutions, of which America and Republicans appear to not be interested in anymore. At least that's what I'm taking from this document. We don't want to be in those organizations anymore, so screw it. China's behavior has negated the optimistic language of our last platform concerning our future relations with China. Ooh. The liberalizing policies of recent decades have been abruptly reversed. Dissent brutally crushed, religious persecution heightened, the internet crippled, a barbaric population control two-child policy of forced abortions and forced sterilizations continued, but
it doesn't.
It stopped. That was ended.
It actually has been fully.
Yeah. So,
and the cult of Mao revived. Not actually.
Wow. Critics of the regime have been kidnapped by its agents in foreign countries. Well, that's true, actually.
That is actually true.
That is true. to distract the populace from its increasing economic problems, and more importantly, to expand its military might, the government asserts a preposterous claim to the entire South China Sea. They have been building islands out there to increase their surface area and expand their border that way. They have
That has now been fought in court.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
What happened?
Let me actually see if I can pull up the information.
Okay. So they continue to dredge ports and create landing fields in contested waters where none have existed before, even nearer to U.S. territories and our allies, while building a navy far out of proportion to defensive purposes. The complacency of the Obama's regime, has emboldened the Chinese government and military to issue threats of intimidation throughout the South China Sea, not to mention parading their new missile, the Guam Killer, down the main streets of Beijing, a direct shot at Guam as America's first line of defense.
It was an arbitrational tribunal under the United Nations Convention for the Law of the Sea. On 12th of July, 2016, the tribunal ruled in favor of the Philippines against China over territorial disputes in the South China Sea. In its major ruling, the tribunal ruled that China has no historical rights based on the nine-dash line map. China has rejected the ruling. Taiwan also rejected the ruling. So, but right now, they're in a stalemate in the South China Sea.
Okay. Interesting. That's very interesting. Okay. So, carrying on. Basically, this is we don't like China anymore, apparently. The return to Maoism by China's current rulers is not a reason to disengage with the Chinese people or their institutions. We welcome students, tourists, investors who can see for themselves our vibrant American democracy and how real democracy works. We caution, however, against academic or cultural operations under the control of the Chinese government and call upon American colleges to dislocate themselves from this increasing threat to academic freedom and honest research. They're doing some really great research in China, actually.
Yeah.
So. Okay, so most of the nations of Southeast Asia have set aside crippling ideologies and sought material progress in free enterprise and democracy. They've become more like us, so yay!
Yeah. The next section. We congratulate the people of Burma on their emergence from authoritarian rule and urge their respect for the rights of their country's minority populations. Except the people of Burma kicked over one military dictatorship to basically form another and are simply killing people who dissent with them.
Yeah. Well, you know who the minority population that they're talking about is.
Yeah, mostly Muslims.
Christians.
That too. Because Burma is Buddhist.
Our improved relations with Vietnam, including arms sales, must advance efforts to obtain an accounting for and reparation of the remains of... Really? That is the worst
repatriation.
Yeah, but that sentence...
Yeah.
I mean, I'm tired, but that sentence structure really stands out as being abysmally creative.
Plus, I love the fact, our improved relations with Vietnam... Is it... It's the, we have to say, hey, look, we're selling them guns.
Yeah.
And then go, but we want to get our bodies back. Why do you need to include arms sales in that?
And
that's a business
right.
prospectus, not part of the RNC platform.
Yeah, that is a business prospectus, isn't it? Yeah. It's an investment opportunity. Investments, right? Yeah. Yeah, we cannot overlook the continued repression of fundamental rights and religious freedom. Again, religious freedom everywhere in the world, as well as the retribution against ethnic minorities and others who assisted U.S. forces during the conflict there. Then we get into India and then into the Middle East. India is our geopolitical ally and a strategic trading partner. The dynamism of its people and the endurance of their democratic institutions are earning their country a position of leadership, not only in Asia, but throughout the world. We encourage the Indian government to permit expanded foreign investment and trade, the key to rising living standards for those left out of their countries energetic economy.
I will say, having actually looked at possibly a future plan of investing in India, yeah, no, their foreign investment thing is, you have to, basically, you need a friend who is an Indian, who is living in country, to be able to do any investing, and their name is the one that's on the main company.
Yeah. That's, I've heard that as well. It's a little difficult to work there, so.
Yeah, it is.
They're definitely keeping it nationalized, though.
Oh, yeah.
You'd think that the Republicans would be pleased with that. Conflicts in the Middle East have created special political and military challenges for the people of Pakistan. Our working relationship is a necessary, though sometimes difficult, benefit to both, and we look forward to the strengthening of historic ties. Okay, so Pakistan? Yeah, just talking about Pakistan, and then particularly regard to Afghanistan. A Republican president will work with all regional leaders to restore mutual trust while insisting upon progress against corruption and the narcotic trade that fuels insurgency.
Getting narcotics there?
Puppies, 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 puppies. Opium, yeah. Opium, more opium.
Yep.
Ah,
congratulations, folks. We have, in a very roundabout way, now read and gone through the very basic, sometimes more than basic,
yeah,
overview of the Republican National Convention 2016 Republican platform. I'm sorry, but if you consider yourself Republican, again, listen to what we've said, read this, and then reevaluate your stance and whether or not you actually are Republican anymore.
That's right. I have nothing left to say about it.
I have lots, but we don't have time.
To this evening, got nothing else to say about this. I did not find myself enjoying it in any way.
Hey, but we can at least say, according to 2012 bullet points, we're Republican. Not sure about this time around, though.
Mostly. We're mostly Republican.
More than 50% Republican.
More than 50% Republican.
As long as we stick to the points themselves and don't dig deep.
That's right. We just might not make that two-thirds majority vote.
So, yeah, might not.
Again, that's it for us tonight. We'll be back Friday about 9:30 p.m. Eastern. In the meantime, the conversations continue on the web. Head over to ORLYRadio.com. That's ORLYRADIO. Not that anybody's listening. You're so done with this show at this point. I'm not surprised at all. But, you know, if our pain has been your pleasure in any way, shape, or form, there is a way that you can contribute to the show. One, put our show in front of other people. Share the show, please. That always helps. Second is, if you do have any spare change to contribute to us, especially on an ongoing basis, that would be fantastic. There is a Patreon account, patreon.com/ORLYRadio, and you can contribute to the show on an ongoing basis and get perks and get early access to shows that have a second part that's more cheerful than what this all was. If that's a little too much, you know, you can also do a one-time donation if that's more your style, straight through the donate button on the webpage. And, of course, on the webpage, you'll find all of our links right at the top so that you can like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, Tumblr, Google+. You can also subscribe to the YouTube channel and also the Twitch feed so you know when we go live and also when we have new content that's been uploaded from the show. Give us a call, 470-222-6759, with any errata and things that you have rambling around in your brain, or if you would just want to text them to us, we'll take a text message at that number, or also at orillyradiopodcast@gmail.com. That's so it. So done.
If you want to yell at me directly, I now have an email address for the show. It's Stephen, Stephen, @orillyradio.com.
And you can reach me at andycowan@andycowan.com if you really so choose. Or, of course, pretty much anything else at O'Reilly Radio will get to me. That's it. Music for the show is created by Kevin McLeod of Incomptech.com, and we'll see you next time. Bye.
Toodles.